All right, the chat room is filling up. We got a lot of folks tuning in already. We're almost at 1,000 people. Oh, man, so we got a lot of stuff to talk about tonight, family, right here on the Ustream show. Again, let me thank everybody who came out for the Code of Conduct tour. I'm finally back home. I've been on the road for a month, touring around the country. Thank you very much, the niggas shirt. What's up to all my niggas? Oh, yeah, Aki is a beast on Twitter. She goes at him on Twitter. Aki is venomous to them white supremacists on Twitter. And the Negro Bedwinches, too. But shout out to everybody, man, on my lecture tour. Shout out to the wonderful people of Philly. I gave all my shout outs last week when I was in Alabama, but I want to give another shout out to Philly, Detroit, Atlanta. Shout out to Alabama. I was over in Birmingham, Alabama. I didn't do a lecture over there, but I was over there. What's up, Nucky Chan? You say I'm looking ashy as hell? No, man, that's just me and your mom. We were rolling around in the gravel, nigga. We were sumo wrestling. I was sumo wrestling her big ass. Thank you very much. A lot of people like the they love the lectures. My man said the Philly lecture was on point. I'm going to have the lecture available. I'm trying to see if I'm going to blend in the lectures from different cities. I'm trying to see how that works, how I'm going to do that, because the footage is good. The only thing, the Detroit footage, it's good, but the mics, because of that janky-ass promoter that I had in Detroit, we didn't do a mic check. The dude didn't know anything about the microphone, so the mic was janky. The mic was real bootleg and janky, so it's not as crisp audio-wise as the Philly and Atlanta lecture. Oh, yeah, and that bitch nigga, he tried to talk some shit on Twitter. That I tried to give that little janky bitch-made nigga some game, but he's just 100% bitch-made. I got zero respect for that nigga. This nigga, when I was out there in Detroit, the nigga avoided me. The dude never even spoke to me when I was there, to be honest. The dude never came to my dressing room. The dude never spoke to me when I was out there. And then when I hollered at him on the show and everything, he got upset and got his panties in a bunch and tried to talk tough on Twitter. I'm like, nigga, if you don't sit your little moist, soft-baked ass down. So he's still salty, and fuck him, little bitch-made nigga. You dig? What's up, Lady More Natural? How are you? Yeah, I said that about you, Lou. Fuck you, dude. You real bitch made and moist, man. I don't play all that internet gangster shit, dude. You saw me in person. You didn't say shit. You didn't come to my dressing room. I was there for hours. Nigga, you didn't come down and say shit to me man to man, but then you get on the internet. Yeah, nigga. Fuck you, nigga. Shut up, dude. Nigga, go somewhere and trim your coochie, nigga. But I digress. Yeah, he's a bitch made. He's a little hater dude. But I ain't tripping. Shout out to Detroit. I got love for the players and the playettes out there in Detroit. Yeah, you dig? That's true. They don't make them like they used to. I'm from a different cloth. You dig? Yeah, I ain't tripping on that shit, man. Yeah, ain't nobody help me with shit, dude. That's my audience. Motherfucker need to be thanking me for helping them get some paper. Dude, I get those kind of numbers every city I go to, so he didn't do shit. My nigga couldn't even do his one job, which was find a good venue and have the audio and everything sounding right. But it is what it is. I ain't tripping on that dusty little nigga. All right, so what's going on, fam? We got a lot to talk about. I got a suspected white supremacist that's supposed to call me at 7:30. There was a lot of people trolling on Twitter about the Sandra Bland situation. A lot of people trolling about that. There was one gentleman, he has a radio show he wanted me to go on. I wouldn't go on it because it's too small time. And he had a couple of black conservatives that he has acting as his shield. So I told him to call in. So he said he's going to call in. So let's see what he's talking about. If he starts trolling, you know, it is what it is. That when they start trolling, they have no real argument. But I want to see what he has to say, because he was kind of saying some disparaging things about our sister Sandra Bland. Yeah. Oh, you said Fraudinista was on Combat Jack? Okay. And that's funny. People like Fraudinista. It's real funny how these people, these pretend trolls who pretend to be black feminists, they get out here and advocate for the white supremacists more law enforcement targeting of black people. Because that was my whole argument with them. Sitting up with the white supremacists and advocating more law enforcement target us. And when law enforcement target us and they harm black men and women, these same fraudulent ass people want to put on a Black Lives Matter t-shirt and then run around in the crowd. That little double agent shit that I ain't with. So black folks, you gotta get a coon and bedwench code. There has to be a code for that, family. There's a coon and bedwench epidemic that's happening, like the Sister Soul Love. Exactly. That's another one who everybody pretty much know is a damn informant at this point, or suspected informant. Because basically she has disappeared from what I understand. She got on her, from some people told me, she said on her Facebook she's going to shut her Facebook down and all her pages down and change her number. So she did exactly what she came to do, which was disrupt, cause friction and havoc, and then disappear. Which I told people from the outset, the minute, y'all got to know how to spot agent provocateurs, man. You have to know how to spot agent provocateurs, because they are all over the place, and some of them are very obvious. Like, the Hurst shit was very obvious. And before I get started, RIP to Bobby Christina, Whitney and Bobby's daughter. She died today. They finally pulled the plug on the young lady. So RIP to her. That's why I played the Whitney Houston Bobby Brown song at the beginning of the show. And I feel a certain way about that too. Because that's another situation where black people end up dying or dead or in comas, and they say it was a suicide or a drug overdose or attempted suicide. And let me be very honest. This is just my personal conjecture. I think there's some funny business going on with the Bobby Christina death as well. I'll say it. I'll just go on. Let me get my tinfoil hat. I'm putting my tinfoil conspiracy hat on with that too. Because I ain't buying that either until I see some more damn evidence. Because there's too many coincidences that happen to wealthy black entertainers and their offspring or their relatives or their loved ones. There's just too many coincidences for me to just accept. All right? I'm putting my tinfoil hat. I might be reaching, but again, I ain't buying nothing until I see all the damn evidence. Because I'm like, the white supremacists, they be orchestrating all types of shit. So, when I see the same pattern go on and on and on, I'm going to ask some questions. And when it comes to mega celebrities like Whitney Houston, Michael Jackson, Bill Cosby, Michael Jordan, people like that, there's always some type of mysterious death in their families. It's always some kind of crazy, unexplained, weird-ass death in their family. Like Michael Jordan. Let's go to Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan, back in the 90s, y'all remember his dad got killed in a real mysterious way. Almost like they were sending him a message. That was just some real off-the-wall shit. His dad just ends up dying because they said his dad pulled over to go to sleep on the freeway and somebody killed him. I was always suspicious about that. And understand this, family. Jennifer Hudson, too. But when you have black entertainers, all right, with a lot of money that the white supremacists give, they allow you to earn like those Mega Millions. That's a whole different ball game when you earn, like, you get into that 20 million and 30 million. That's a whole different ball game. The white supremacist, one of the unwritten codes that a lot of black people are not aware of, they don't, the name of the game is to not let you really, not allow you to pass that paper down. Because, see, wealth and money and white supremacy is all about keeping resources away from the next generation. So they don't really like to allow, let me reach them. A lot of black entertainers are not allowed to pass that money down for some reason. Think about that. Which mega million black celebrity do you know that has passed down multi-millions of dollars? Just like with Bill Cosby. Now look at Bill Cosby. His one and only son mysteriously got killed on a freeway. That whole freeway thing again. And now they're tearing up Bill Cosby's legacy and his image, then destroying that shit. So when he dies, they're going to be like vultures. He has no heir to pass the money down, so they're going to be like vultures on his estate. They're going to be like vultures on that estate. Got it? And look at Michael Jackson. Michael Jackson, they're like, right now, to this very day, Michael died mysteriously when the person who killed him, Conrad Murray, is walking around right now. So that money, the Michael Jackson estate, that's so up in the air right now. They're fighting over that now. They're in court now over that damn Michael Jackson estate. So now let's look at Whitney Houston. Whitney Houston only had one daughter. Whitney died mysteriously. I mean, these are a lot of damn coincidences. Hell, look at, let me go back. Even Wesley Snipes. Let's look at Wesley. They got Wesley. Wesley Snipes. Do y'all know the Blade movie series? That started all of this Marvel comic shit that y'all see now. All of these Marvel comic book movies that you see now, all of that shit started with Blade. I'm going to say it again. All those Marvel comic movies, Spider-Man, The Adventure.
AC is so not cool.
All that stuff, hold on.
Yeah, but what can I do about it? Fix yourself with AC Pro.
Save time and money recharging your AC with AC Pro.
So we cool?
We're cool.
Everyone's a pro.
All right. We'll just take that down for a minute. But let me break that down, though. Let me break it down. Now, Wesley Snipes started the whole Marvel comic craze. Wesley Snipes' Blade kicked all that off. When Blade came out and they saw like this, the dark comic book action movie. Because remember, the comic book movies before Blade, you know, like Batman, everything was kind of comic, kind of cheesy almost. You dig? It was almost cartoonish. But Blade, it brought like a darkness and a depth. So that was such a success. Blade started all that off. Then they came up with the Spider-Mans and all that stuff. So Wesley was the dude. And he was making a lot of paper. And Wesley started trying to call shots. Then they start throwing those cases on him. They start throwing those bogus-ass cases on him. And let's look at Whitney again. Whitney died mysteriously. That was a mysterious-ass death that she had. She got a drug overdose and drowned in a bathtub. That was real mysterious. And she has one heir, which is her daughter, to that fortune she has. Now, the daughter dies mysteriously, and they try to say it was a suicide. But we all know that there were mysterious, shady people around Bobby Christina. Some real janky type of people that nobody's really going into who they were and what were they doing around her and who these people were. The family is talking about some of these janky, shady people around her. You understand what I'm saying? So now she dies. So now that Whitney Houston estate has no heirs. So now who's going to get all that Whitney Houston money? Who's going to get all that publishing? I mean, Whitney Houston had hit after hit after hit. So that money is going to make, I mean, her catalog is going to make money into perpetuity. So now where the fuck is the money going? Where's the money going now? You think that's what I want to know. And look, Oprah, now, Oprah's been spared to a certain degree because she don't have no kids, but damn, can somebody call Stedman tonight and see if he all right? I don't want Stedman to get knocked off driving home on the freeway. Somebody call Stedman and see what's popping. My God. Yeah, Spawn, that's not a Marvel comic one, I don't think. So we got to understand how this game is. It's just too many coincidences for me. Too many coincidences. Too many coincidences for me. And when they, that whole suicide thing, every time a black person ends up dead, they immediately say it's a suicide. And I put up some post of Asada Shakur back in the 80s in her autobiography talking about how in jail many black people end up dead and the white supremacists say that it's suicide. They hang themselves. That's a common lie. So with this case with our sister, Sandra Bland, people are correct with being suspicious because you have a law enforcement or race soldier pulling her over really for no reason. The race soldier officer pulled her over for no reason. Johnny Sack Jr., stop trolling, brother. Johnny Sack, I'm going to have to get you out the room. Stop trolling. You're putting up the names of websites, and come on, man, y'all, some of y'all niggas from these little corny message boards, y'all acting bitch-made. Don't bring that bitch-made bullshit over here. Y'all got to keep it play over here. Keep that corny bitch-made nigga shit somewhere else. All right? Okay, Lodi. Okay, I'm going to have to start banning some people up in this bitch. All right? I'm going to ban Lodi because you bring in some janky nigga energy. Johnny Sack, you in here being bitch made. All right, y'all. Take that back to one of y'all little moist nigga rest haven websites that y'all be trolling on. Y'all troll each other. That's the problem. The internet has little pockets of bitch niggas that sit around and be gangster with each other. Take that shit on somewhere. But there, the cop, when the cop pulled over Sandra Bland, he was clearly trying to provoke a response. He was acting like a race soldier, doing what they do to black innocent pedestrians who are not doing anything. They make up certain laws when it comes to us, when they pull us over. They make up reasons. You didn't have your turn signal on long enough. You were driving too close to that car. You can literally make up any reason to pull a person over. That's why black folks, when black people are attacked by these race soldier cops, and you get on this, well, we shouldn't have been doing it. Stop with that. We shouldn't have been doing shit. Because if you're just driving normally, if a white supremacist feels like targeting you that day, we live in a system called white supremacy. They can make up anything they need to make up. They have a whole set of codes that they use against you. He was resisting arrest. He made a turn without waiting 3 seconds. He was more than 2 feet behind a car. He was driving too slow. If somebody arrests you for not having on your turn signal, they want to arrest you. They want to pull you over. They're targeting you. And I noticed that a long time ago. L.A., Los Angeles is like, what, 8 or 9% black? And I remember back in the day when I would go to traffic court downtown L.A., it would be mostly black people in there. And I thought to myself, I said, wait a minute. We're only 8% of this whole fucking city, but this place is packed with black people with parking violations. In a city that's over 90%, well, not because it's Hispanic too, but at least, what, 70% at the time? White, it was 70% white, 30% Hispanic, something like that. I'm going to get on the mugshot in a minute. But I'm like, okay, even then, as a young dude, I said, this don't make no sense. It ain't no way that just black folks don't know how to drive. There's just no way. So what they do, they use traffic laws and traffic stops as a way to Jim Crow the black population. Because I had white friends who would, these dudes would be drunk, driving crazy, and they would never get pulled over. Or if they get pulled over, the cops would be like, hey, just get on out of here, beat it. So they get a white privilege pass. We all know that that's true. This is true. And that's what happened with our sister. She was targeted. The police officer provoked a response, lied about how the interaction went. I think he lied and said that she assaulted him, and we clearly see that she did not assault him. So our sister goes to jail, and there's a lot of mysterious stuff that's happening. She ended up, they said she hung herself in the jail cell, but that makes no sense. Number one, why would you hang yourself over a traffic violation? You're going to get out. So why would you hang yourself over a traffic violation? Her family and friends said that she was not suicidal. The white supremacists are trying to say that she was depressed and she was mentally ill. No. Nothing was wrong with that sister. They're trying to blame weed. They're trying to bring up she had weed in her system. Weed is legal in many states. Weed is legal in many states, so California is a weed state. They got legal medical marijuana. If that were the case, everybody in California would be suicidal. Let's stop with the whole weed thing. And I ask anybody, any of you white supremacists or suspected white supremacists, show me a case of weed-induced suicide. Just show me a case of a marijuana-induced suicide where a motherfucker smoked some weed and then killed himself. Just show me a case of that. When people are on weed, the last thing they want to do is kill themselves. They want to sit up and enjoy that high. So, see, the white supremacists will do stuff and then make up some of the reasons why they did it. Now, some people are saying they're circulating around the mugshot. They're saying that she may have been dead in the mugshot. I don't know how true that is. I don't know. Because we got to be very careful, family, because, see, the white supremacists, they will throw out misinformation just to have people running in circles so you're not focusing directly on white supremacists. So you got to be very careful because the white supremacists will throw out misinformation. But there is a lot of sketchy stuff that happened at that jail. Let me see who this is. I wonder if this is that white supremacist. What's up? Who's calling?
What's up, Tariq? This is C from D.C.
I'm going to have you call back, C. I want that, what's that guy's name who's supposed to call me at 7:30? I want him to call up. What's up? Who's calling? Hello? Okay, I have him call up. You know who you are. I gave you the number, guy. I can't think of his name. This so-called Christian conservative. I wanted to see what he had to say. But there's some mysterious stuff that went down with the situation with Sandra going to jail. Oh, I'm looking at my Twitter. Now, they said that there's video of the jail, but all the video footage that they have of the jail or inside the jail, they mysteriously don't show what happened before they wheeled her out. There's video footage of them wheeling her out, so-called after the fact. But they don't see what happened before or during the so-called suicide. And again, the mugshot is kind of questionable because she has on her orange jail jumpsuit in the mugshot, which is kind of rare for a person who has no criminal priors. Now, she has some traffic violations before, but no real criminal priors before. Or she wasn't a celebrity, so usually when you see a person in their mugshot and they have on the orange jumpsuit, either they're like a special, you know, like a celebrity or something, or they have priors. But most places, what they do, and I've been to jail many times. I'm not ashamed to say that. I've been to jail in 5 or 6 different states. One thing that they've always done in these different jails, they arrest you, they book you, they process you, they fingerprint you, they mugshot you, then they strip you, search you, then put you in the county-issued outfits. And that's protocol in damn near every jail I've been to. And even the Waller County Jail that Sandra was in, on their website, all the people with mugshots are in their street clothes. If you look at the Waller County mugshot where Sandra was arrested, all of the people there had on their street clothes in the mugshot, which is normal. Most mugshots, you see people in their street clothes. So it's very interesting why she was already in her county outfit in the mugshot. So I don't know. I'm not coming to a conclusion. I'm just saying a lot of stuff is real funny style as far as that. A lot of stuff is real funny style. And also, another thing, when people, the jailers are talking about what she said, she was once contemplating suicide or whatever, and they're trying to use that to justify her committing suicide. Okay, if that's the case, why did they let a person who claimed to be formerly suicidal, why would they put them in a jail in a cell without putting them on suicide watch? Why would they put a garbage can with a bag that could be used as contraband in the jail cell with her? Excuse me. Why would they do that? There's a lot of questions here. Why would they not put you on suicide watch? And in jail, protocol in all, damn near all jails, you take everything out that could be used to harm themselves or another inmate. You don't put nothing in jail that could harm another inmate or himself or herself. You don't do that. That's how sagging got started. Out here in California, sagging got started because what happened? They didn't want the gang members, when they went to jail, they didn't want them using their shoestrings or their belts as weapons or as a way to commit suicide. So when you went to jail out here in California, they took your shoestrings and they took your belt, and cats' pants would sag. You dig? So that's where all that came from. So they take everything. Not only that, when women go to jail, they take out, a lot of times they'll take your weave out. They don't let you, if you got a lace front, they will cut that shit out of your hair. They don't let you have nothing. If you got a scrunchie, or they take all that shit out. Because some women can use weaves as weapons. They can snatch a lace front out. They'll snatch your lace front out. So now, they done put this sister in a jail cell with a trash bag and a garbage can. So that's funny style. That's real funny style. And that's not even, to be honest, I've never really been in a jail with a garbage can in it like that. I've never been in a jail with a garbage can and a garbage bag. Not like that. That's funny style, to be honest. A garbage can in a jail, first of all, what you throwing away? Because when they give you food, you ain't supposed to put it in a garbage can. What they do, when they give you food, you finish food, put the trash on the tray, or what they'll do, they'll bring the trash can out when you're eating so that you could kind of dump it outside the cell in the trash can. Who is this? What's up, Tia? Yeah, this is my sister, Tia. Yes, they take your underwear in some places. And she was telling me, my sister, shout out to my sister Tia. She said out there in Michigan, they take your bra. Yeah. So I'm like, well, they scrub you down. They make sure you ain't got, they look all up in your asshole. The women, they look all up in your cooch. They up there looking in your womb. They look in, they look for all this paraphernalia, but they're going to leave a damn garbage bag. All right. That's, again, that's questionable. And what kind of garbage bag was that, too? If we're going to talk, what kind of garbage, that's a strong garbage bag. What kind of garbage bag was that? I took out the garbage today. I had some damn Domino's pizza boxes in that motherfucker and it broke. So what kind of garbage bags are they using? Because the state, they use usually state-issued shit. They give you the cheapest, most low-quality, weakest garbage bags imaginable. But now this garbage bag just happened to be able to hang a grown person in a small-ass space. Okay, that's a strong fucking garbage bag they had. Good grief. So a lot of questions are there. Just a lot of questions there. I'm just saying, throwing some questions out there. What's up? Who's calling? Okay. Where's that dude? Did he chicken out? Where is he? Let me find that dude. Let me find that dude who's supposed to call up. Yeah, man, jail. They use the cheapest form of everything. They use cheap sheets, cheap pillows, cheap mattresses. But now they got the most durable, heavy-duty garbage bags. Okay, all right. All right. All right. Okay, I see some people are trolling on Twitter. The trolls need to call in. What's up? Who's calling?
This is Akin from Austin, Texas.
What's up, Akin? How you doing, fam? What's up? How far is Texas from Waller or Harris County, Texas? How far is that?
I'm actually not sure, man.
You know, goddamn. You're like one of these niggas who don't be knowing shit. All right, what's on your mind, man?
Yeah, mine's kind of off subject a little bit, but I was watching your show about 3 weeks ago. You said that Donald Trump really wasn't running for president, so I wanted to know if you still feel like that or you changed your mind on that topic.
No, he's not. Donald Trump is out here trolling. He's out here trolling for attention. There's no way Donald Trump is going to get elected for president, and he knows that. Donald Trump is too loose and reckless at the mouth. I don't believe all these polls talking about his numbers are up and all that. Donald, there's no way in hell Donald Trump is going to win the presidency as reckless as he is. Donald Trump just does a lot of shit for the publicity. He does a lot of stuff to get attention, to kind of bring attention to his brand. Donald Trump has alienated a whole culture of people, the whole Hispanic community. So him getting elected would alienate the United States and fuck up diplomatic ties. So he ain't about to get elected. He's out here trolling for his next venture. He's a P.T. Barnum. You know, he's like a carnival salesman. You know, and he's pandering to the lowest common denominator, which are the white supremacists. So he's not a serious forerunner. The media just, they're running with it, making it seem like he's a serious contender because, you know, they get ratings for having his clown bullshit on TV, but he's not going to get elected. It's not happening. You feel me?
I disagree with you on that, but I understand.
You think Donald Trump is going to get elected?
I think it's a possibility, yes.
Okay. All right. Well, we just disagree on that. All right. Well, you say it and I say you don't. So you're entitled to your opinion, so I ain't mad at you, fam. Thank you for the call. Yeah, I'm not going to debate him. If he thinks he's going to get elected, hey, so more power to you. More power to you. Donald Trump is trolling. Donald Trump ain't about to be the next president. Acting a fool like that. Let's see who we got. What's up? Who's calling?
What's up? Hello?
What's up, man? Who's this?
Hello?
Yes.
Oh, okay. I've got to
I just asked you a question. Hello?
What's your name, brother?
My name is Monte, M-O-N-T-E.
Where you calling from?
Atlanta, Georgia.
Hey, what's on your mind, man?
I had came to your lecture, and I had asked Snow, but I was asking you, what Bible should we be reading from?
Oh, I would say the Hebrew Bible, because that's the original one. So the original Hebrew Bible, to get more of a literal translation, because the King James Version, you know, that has a lot of added stuff in it. And there's a lot of codes and little secret messages in the King James Version of the Bible. So I would say the original Hebrew Bible, if you can get that and get that in an English translation. But thank you for the call, sir. And thank you for coming out to the lecture, sir. Again, shout out to my Atlanta audience. Shout out to my brother Snow. He introduced me when I was out there. But again, man, with our sister, man, Sandra Bland, I'm not buying that suicide thing. I'm not buying it, because what we have is a bunch of white supremacists. Now, one of the prosecutors out there where she was arrested, he's a suspected white supremacist. He has been in hot water over racial incidents. The sheriff over that jail where Sandra was arrested and what we think was killed, he's a known white supremacist. He was fired for some of his white supremacist views. So it's not a stretch of the imagination when you have these white supremacists in this little town targeting a black person who's outspoken, and then this black person ends up dead. So we're not reaching here. And then you have all of these people working in concert with each other. The person who did the autopsy report, the medical examiner, her name is Sarah Doyle. Sarah Doyle. She was the medical examiner who came out and said, hey, no foul play. This was suicide. This was the medical examiner. Her husband, his name is Paul Doyle, who used to work for the goddamn prosecutor at the DA out there in Harris County. Her husband worked at the DA office as a lawyer. So you see all of these people are working all in bed with each other. Look those names up, Paul Doyle and Sarah Doyle. Sarah Doyle was the medical examiner. Her husband used to work in the district attorney's office out there in that area. So tell me that's not a conflict of interest. Look that up, because there was some white supremacist trolls trying to challenge me on that, because I got the name of the county wrong. It wasn't Waller County, because the thing is, Waller County, people are using Waller County and Harrison County. They're kind of interchanging these counties, so it gets a little mixed up. But it's Harrison County or Harris County. Am I pronouncing it right? Because there's a lot of names here. The point is, the medical examiner, her husband, used to work at the DA's office out there. You dig? So you tell me that shit is not no damn a hell of a coincidence. So no wonder she's coming out saying, okay, well, there's no foul play. Sarah Doyle, Harris County. Look it up, Sarah Doyle. Let me put that up. Sarah Doyle. Harris County, yeah. So yeah, her husband was a prosecutor out there working for the DA. So these people they're all clicked in, dude. All of these white supremacists are clicked in, just like in Ferguson. It's just like Ferguson. All of these people are clicked in. And we ain't supposed to call that out. Now, y'all remember in Baltimore when Marilyn Mosby came out and they found out her husband was a councilman? The white supremacists raised holy hell. Oh, no. Oh, no. This is a conflict of interest. They raised hell out there in Baltimore over Marilyn Mosby. So all of these people are working in concert with each other, man. So it's correct for us to look at our sister's death suspiciously, because you got a bunch of people who are liars and you got a bunch of people who are white supremacists proven all around this case. And we could see that the sister was racially targeted. She was pulled over unjustly, abused by that cop, and lied on. So it's not a stretch or a reach for us to question the validity of that so-called suicide. And everybody who knows her said she wasn't suicidal at all. And there would be no reason to be suicidal over a damn traffic violation. You getting out. So we got to stop playing these games with these white supremacists. And the coon train is heavy. All of the coon train, like Stephen A. Smith has gone full coon at this point. Stephen A. Smith has gone full coon. Dennis Rodman, he didn't put on the coon hat because of Hulk Hogan. Now, Hulk Hogan, for those who don't know, and Hulk Hogan, he's been outed. He's been outed as using the N-word. And a lot of black people were trying to make excuses for him. But I'm not shocked with Hulk Hogan. He kind of looks like, you know, he's fun and entertaining to watch as a wrestler. But, you know, he panders to that redneck white supremacist crowd. So it's that Dog the Bounty Hunter crowd. I'm not shocked with Hulk Hogan. I'm not shocked. He was saying some stuff about his daughter dating niggers and all that. So I'm so not shocked, because I know his daughter likes brothers. His daughter likes brothers. I met his daughter one time out here in L.A. in Beverly Hills. I got a little soft choosing vibe. I already knew. You can tell. The grin was a little bit too long. You dig? The soft choosing vibe. So I knew. You know. So he was talking about his daughter dating niggers and all that old shit. So I'm not shocked, but the Negroes coming out to defend him, when this person proves himself as a white supremacist, and niggas are still defending him. George Foreman, he's on the coon train. All of these older black folks with this coon train, they're just fighting each other to get on the coon train. What was that that former athlete? I put a link up on my Facebook page. He used to play for the 49ers, I think. He said, "How come more athletes don't act like white people?" What's his name? Y'all throw that name at me. Y'all know who I'm talking about. He's a retired athlete, football player. He said, "How come the young athletes today don't act like white people?" Not Charles Barkley, no. Is it Charles Haley? Charles Haley, that's him. This coon. So these dudes are just tripping over each other to buck dance. They're tripping over each other to buck dance. Let me see who's on the phone. What's up, who's calling?
Hey, this is Terry, man. How you doing, brother?
What's up, Terry? How you doing, fam?
Hey, good, man. Hey, I just wanted to say something to you. I'm from Texas. I live out here in Texas. I'm a nurse, and I work up in the corrections. Okay. And just... Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Go ahead, brother. I was just agreeing with what you're saying. Go ahead.
Oh, yeah. I was just saying about all the stuff that's going on with this system and everything, is the protocol is totally wrong.
Yeah.
Usually when you get somebody in central booking, as soon as you say those words, suicide attempt, they don't care if it's been 5 years, 20 years, you could have been 2 years old. As soon as you say that, they automatically put you in the system, as far as they put you in a cell where you're not going to hurt yourself. Absolutely. They take all your clothes. They put you in a little Velcro gown and all this stuff. And they had a psych doctor come out there and talk to you. And every 15 minutes, somebody's out there looking at you.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So, yeah, they ain't going to wiggle out of that. They're trying to say, okay, she said she was suicidal. Okay, let's go with that. Let's say she was suicidal and she told you she was suicidal in the past. That whole system there needs to be shut down overhauled. They need to pay out the family for allowing her to kill herself then, if that's the case. Because you are not supposed to put a person in that cell under no circumstance if they say that they're suicidal. So I totally agree with that. Because, look, in jail, if you say anything, if you say you're sick, if you say you got any kind of mental problem, if your ear hurt, they put you somewhere. They got places in jail to put you. They're not supposed to put you in no general pop or no regular jail cell. If you have anything going on, you did. Look, I live out here in L.A., man. In L.A., the L.A. County Jail, dude, they separate you for anything. They got the Crip cell, the blood cell, the SA cell, the transgender cell, the Asian gang cell, the retarded cell, the headlight cell, the AIDS cell, the suicide cell, the moist nigga cell. They got the snitch cell. They know how to separate you, man. The minute you say something is going on with you, they know where to put you. So they got to be accountable, man.
Oh, most definitely. Like you were saying before, man, they don't let you have anything in these cells that can hurt you or any other inmates, let alone an officer or a nurse or anybody at the staff.
Yes, indeed.
There's no reason for a garbage can to be in there with a garbage bag on top of that. And it's sitting there perfectly placed.
Yeah.
Come on, man. Yeah. How stupid do they think we are?
I know, right in the middle of the goddamn floor. I'm like, I ain't never, ever, ever, ever seen no shit like that. Ever, ever, ever. That shit, it looks so staged. A garbage can with a bag right in the middle of a jail cell. I've never seen that. Ever, ever, ever. You dig? So, you know, I'm glad people are calling out the fuckery with that, man.
Most definitely. Because, like I said, the last thing I'm going to let you go, because I know you got a lot of people. Even when you watch the tape, like the officers, they have no sense of urgency to go in there. They like to get, you see the EMT going in there. But the officer, the black dude, was sitting there by the garbage can dumping something in there. We don't know what that is. And then all of a sudden, she got this super killer weed that will put every weed man out of business.
Yeah.
You mean to tell me she get hit some weed on a Friday, and she was still high till Monday?
Yeah.
She was so high that she took her own life. Get the fuck out of here. Come on, man.
Exactly. Exactly, man. Thank you for the call, fam.
Hey, man. You have
Yes, indeed. Yeah, that's that whole other thing with the whole she was on weed. Even though weed stay in your system, weed don't keep you high for days. Let's stop with that whole white supremacist. Stop with the whole weed. It was weed impaired her mental state was impaired by weed. Weed don't keep you high for days like that. So let's stop with that shit. You can detect it in your system for a long time, but using that as some type of excuse to her mental state at the moment, stop that. That's an insult to intelligence. Let's see who we got. What's up? Who's calling?
Hey, good night. What's up, good homie?
What's up, man? Who's this?
It's Tariq from Brooklyn, man.
What's up, family? You got that Caribbean accent. Where you from originally?
Yo, first thing first, man, I want to thank you for everything you've been doing, man.
Yes, indeed.
Yo, it's such a positive vibe, man. One of my mans, I called you up the other day, what's his name? I think something Bailey, but yeah, put me on to you, man. Ever since, man, I've been on to you, man. But I want to ask you a question, man. In Hidden Cars 1, right?
Yes, sir.
I think y'all said something about white people evolving from black people. I didn't really understand that.
Well, that was in, we talked about that in Hidden Colors 2. We talked about... We talked about the original people, and the BBC, I think they did a documentary on this too, or a special on this, about the original people of Europe were a group of black people called the Grimaldi. All right?
Right.
And what happened, there was an ice age. The last ice age was called the Wormian Ice Age. And what happened is that these people, these African people, got caught up in that ice age. And what happened was the ice, they basically depigmented themselves because there would be no need to have that strong of melanin within an ice age. And certain features were formed, like the slimming of the nose to warm the air.
Okay,
So we broke all that down. And this is just scientific documented stuff. So
yeah, man, that's deep, man. Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. I'm in Cars 4, man. That's it, man.
Yes, and then where you from again, man? Where you didn't tell me where your people were from. Where you from?
Oh, my background is from Trinidad. I'm in Brooklyn. I was born in Brooklyn.
Much respect, man. Thank you for the call, brother.
Yeah, man. You already know, man.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, indeed. So I guess that white supremacist ain't calling up. He was talking all this shit about he was going to call up. And he tried to have some of his coons try to debate me on Twitter. And I shut them down. You dig? Man, did y'all see MTV did a show called, what was that show called about white privilege? It was called White People something. What was that show called on MTV? Y'all gotta see this. I think y'all could see it on YouTube. And shout out to MTV. They tried. What's up, Kim Mose? I have you call in, Kim Mose. The number is 818-850-5404. But did y'all see the MTV special called White People? Where basically, there was a guy, he was like white and Filipino or something like that. And he was going to other white people to talk about race. To talk about how they felt about race and how they felt about being white. And they should have called that the denial show. It was just so much denial going on. It's so much denial. It was basically an hour of, well, I'm not racist, but, you know, I know that racism is over there. It's everybody deflecting about what racism is. You know what I'm saying? That's racism. Well, my dad, he watches Fox News, so, you know, they kept just pointing the finger at somebody else. It was that type of thing. The racism is over there. Well, in my city, in my town, you know, there's whispers of racism. It was such a denial. And it was the fat white girl. And I'm not trying to say this to disparage anybody, but people who saw it, they know who I'm talking about. Oh, yeah, it was that, well, my friends are black, you know, it was that type of thing. It was real they were being overly politically correct, you know. Then they got into this, well, when I tried to apply for a student loan, I can't get a student loan because I'm not a minority. So I'm a victim too. Now, the white girl told the interviewer this, and then he went and found out that's totally bullshit. He went and talked to somebody else, another white person, who's like, you know, to be honest, that's bullshit. You know, white people, we get, you know, white people get like 40 times more loans, student loans and scholarships than black people. So the interviewer went back to the white girl, the fat white girl who sat up here complaining about how she couldn't get no student loan and she couldn't get no scholarship because she was white and because all the minorities are getting them. Which I wanted to jump through the screen and just ask one simple question. Where in the fuck are all of these scholarships and all of these schools that black people are going to that you can't go to? That's, sometimes y'all just make it real simple. I just wanted to just jump through the screen and ask one simple question. Can you please point to the school where all these black people are getting in on these scholarships and we just rolling in scholarships and you can't get one? Name the school. Name one. So the dude came back to her, said, you know, hey, you know, we did some research and, you know, it's kind of not true. You can get scholarships. As a matter of fact, you as a white person, you can get 40% more scholarships than black people. Boy, she went right into victim mode. She was like, I think you're attacking me. I said, oh, I'm done with this shit. Boy, she went into victim mode so fast. When you start hitting them up with stats and debunking all their bullshit, they go right into victim mode. Because y'all remember, I did a debate with a white supremacist a couple of years ago right here. And he tried to use, I think Johnny, one of those dudes, He tried to use that, well, Tariq, you blacks can get all the scholarships, and we can't. So that's black privilege. I said, Johnny, dude, they have so many scholarships for white people. If you are, you got Scottish descent, there's scholarships for people with Scottish descent. There's scholarships for people with Irish descent. There's scholarships for people with English ancestry. There's scholarships for people with German ancestry. Very specific to your ancestry and your lineage. They have scholarships. So stop lying. Please, please call these people out on their lies when they start telling that shit about black people are getting all of this shit that they ain't getting. That's a lie. Oh, they hate the truth. They'll start making up facts. But that documentary was funny. Check it out if you can. If you want to see an hour of just denial. What's up? Who's calling? Hello? All right. This nigga's quiet. Let's get somebody else. Hey, what's up? Who's calling?
Tariq?
Hey, who's this?
This is Kristen.
Hey, Kristen.
From Philly.
Hey, Kristen from Philly. How are you?
Good. I'm so hyped I got in.
Yes, indeed. Now, did you come to my lecture in Philly?
Yes, I did.
Oh, man. Did I meet you afterwards or what?
No, I couldn't stay. I had to go pick up my kids.
Oh, okay. Well, how were you, love? Did you enjoy the lecture out there in Philly? Did you enjoy it?
Yes, it was great.
Yes, indeed. I had a great time with Philly, man. The energy was wonderful. So what's on your mind, young lady?
So I have a question, because I'm catching the stream late.
Yes.
So I don't know if anybody asked already about this whole anonymous community thing on Facebook.
Right.
About the whole Sandra Bland. What is that? Is that fake? Is that something that's real? They trying to do a day of rage. I mean, what do you think about that?
You know what, to be honest, and this is something, because a lot of black folks, we follow the conspiracy theories, and you know, I look at some conspiracy theories, but we got to be careful. Because with Anonymous, we got to watch out for them. We don't know who that is. They could be CIA plants. We don't really know because, again, I remember doing the whole Mike Brown situation. Anonymous was talking about they're going to reveal who the cops are and all that. And they were giving out wrong information. I never forgot that. They were giving out false information. So they could be somebody that's down with the CIA designed to give fake information. So also with Anonymous recently, they put out a Photoshop picture of like Sandra Bland with her eyes rolled back. That picture is totally fake. So Now when people do that, now I'm looking at you funny style now. Now I'm looking at you funny. You dig? So I got to take whatever they say with a grain of salt. So, because if they say one thing that I know is incorrect, what else are they saying that's incorrect? So we got to be careful. You feel me?
Yeah, I feel you.
Yeah, thank you. You got your kids in there. It sounds like they want some juice. Go out there, give them kids some graham crackers.
Yeah, the baby.
Yes,
you know, I love your show. I'm a fan. I read the book, everything. So just keep doing. I'm watching. I'm listening.
Thank you, love. Thank you. Thank you for coming out and seeing me in Philly, too.
Thanks.
Yes, indeed. So that's going to be available pretty soon, family. The Code of Conduct lecture is going to be available pretty soon. Let me see who this is. What's up? Who's calling? Hello? Hey, nigga, you in a bath? You soaking? And you dropped the phone in your bubbles? Hello? This bitch nigga hung up. You moist bastard. That nigga had on a plastic bag over his head in a damn bubble bath with Bed Bath & Beyond aroma beads tickling his taint. Say something next time, nigga. What's up? Who's calling? Hey, what's up, man?
This nigga hung up. You moist bastard.
Hey.
Hey, Tariq, how you doing?
Hey, what's up? Who is this?
This is Kim Moon. How you doing? Just showing you some love from Chicago.
Hey, what's happening out there in Chicago, Kim?
What'd you say?
What's happening out there in Chicago, love?
Not so much. I'm trying to build some businesses, and August the 1st, I'm going to Case and Black meeting in August, so I'm very excited.
There you go.
I saw you this year when you spoke here in Chicago, so I was very happy to meet you.
Yes, indeed. Thank you so much for coming out.
No, thank you for even, like, putting stuff like that together, because you have a lot of people that are afraid to do stuff.
Yeah. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. So what else is on your mind, young lady?
Well, let's talk about, everybody likes to talk about Bill Cosby and his, and how he, like, raped all these women. But let's be truthful here. Like, how is a black man back in the 1960s and 70s going to rape, like, 40 white women and be alive today?
Yeah, man. That's why I don't believe it, because them women would have came up then and there. They ain't gonna wait no 40 years. If a brother raped them, you got a whole system that will cash you out right then and there. So if Bill Ridley raped somebody and drugged him and all that old shit, they would have filed charges right there in 1960 and 70 and whenever they said he did it. You feel me?
Yeah, but nobody wants to talk about the guys from Seventh Heaven or Willie Allen and, you know, what's that, the cop who arrested Sandra. No, he had a history of racism and sexual abuse towards black women.
Wow, I got to look into that. But anyway, thank you for the call, young lady. Let me see who else we got. Real heavy shit, man. Let me see. I can't wait till the NWA movie come out. I almost said NAACP movie. I'm like, what the fuck? I've already seen the NAACP movie. It's called 12 Years a Slave. What's up? Who's calling? All right. Niggas hanging up. Speaking of slave, I was down in Birmingham, Alabama. Any Alabama people here? Where are my Alabama people? I was just down in Birmingham. Shout out to Birmingham. I was just down in Birmingham, Alabama. How many people we got in the room right now, by the way? I was in Birmingham, Alabama. Peep this, man. And y'all know I used to live in Birmingham as a kid. As a child, we moved from Detroit to Birmingham. Then I left Birmingham and came out to L.A. So I lived in an area called West End. Now, you from Birmingham, you know where West End is. Shout out to West End. We went to West End High School. West End, I rep West End. See, because our little neighborhoods and high schools, they were almost like gangs. Oh, yeah, Aki lived down in Birmingham. You were born in Anniston, man. We used to go down to Anniston. We got into a fight with down in the whole city of Anniston one time. Long story. But I lived in West End, and I love West End. Love it to this day. A lot of fond memories of West End. I was like the ambassador for West End. West End was kind of a rowdy spot. But it was cool, though. That was my home. Oh, yeah, I got my back scratcher. Okay. So every time I go to Birmingham, I go back to visit West End. Last time I went to visit West End, they tore my little high school down. Tore West End down. They built up something else. When I went there the other day, there's like the West End Academy. I don't know what kind of school that is, but they tore down the high school and built another school there. But West End looks like a damn zombie apocalypse hit that shit. The West End area of Birmingham, it looked, because when I was up in Detroit, a lot of parts of Detroit where I used to live, when I stayed with my aunt over on the east side, that's all dilapidated and tore up and decrepit and houses are just abandoned. And over here in West End, I'm driving around my old neighborhood and just every other house is abandoned, tore up, burned up. It was just heartbreaking seeing that. I went by the house that I used to live in. Now, somebody lives there now. But just the whole neighborhood, it looks like The Walking Dead. It's just like, you don't hardly see no people. The houses all run down and abandoned and empty. It just looked like a nuclear bomb hit that shit. Tuscaloosa Avenue, I know about that street. So we're driving around West End. Now, West End is all toe up, toe down. And there's one real nice house in the West End area. There's a former slave plantation that's still there. It's one of the few antebellum plantations that's still up in Birmingham, called the Arlington House. Now, that's a tourist attraction, and it's a museum today. But the nicest house in this dilapidated, rundown area is a former slave plantation right in the middle of the hood. You feel me? It's called Arlington House. Arlington House is on a street called Cotton Avenue in Birmingham, Alabama. Right now, see how they get down? It's on Cotton Avenue. Now, folks in Birmingham, y'all know where Cotton Avenue is. A lot of people don't know why Cotton Avenue is named Cotton Avenue. It's named Cotton Avenue because it's a damn slave plantation that's still up and running, basically, as a tourist attraction. All right? So we go to the slave plantation on Cotton Avenue. I went there the other day, and I'm driving around the plantation. It's huge, big old plantation, right in the middle of the hood. I'm looking for the slave quarters because, you know, when you see a plantation, there's slave quarters. And I'm looking in the back. There were no slave quarters in the back. So I'm like, where in the fuck? Where's the slave quarters? Then I look directly across the street because the slave quarters in antebellum slavery houses are either in the directly in the back of the house or it's usually down the hill. So at Arlington House, directly down the hill where the slave quarters should be, is a housing project. And I'm like, this shit is hitting me. I'm like, wait a minute. Wait a minute. It's a housing project. So these people, there's no way that's a coincidence. It's 2015. You got a running, operational slave plantation that's still in existence with occupied slave quarters right next to it on Cotton Avenue. I said, boy, these white supremacists are slick. I said, these white supremacists are slick. Ain't no way in hell. Oh, my third eye kicked in. I'm like, wait a fucking minute. I can't find the slave plantations because the slave plantations and the slave quarter is still in damn operation. Yeah. That's a rundown Section 8 housing project directly across the street. I parked there to walk across the street to take pictures of the plantation. The minute I parked my car, niggas running up. Hey, man, can I have some money? Dude's begging for money. Ain't no way that's by accident. There's no way that's an accident. They're bold with it. They know. They sit back and create that type of shit and sit back and laugh at it. So, dude, I'm telling you, if you go to Birmingham, Alabama, if you're in Birmingham, all my Birmingham people, go down to the addresses. I think it's 331 or either 336 Cotton Avenue, which is hilarious, and you will see a shiny, bright, clean, sparkling slave plantation that's up and running right now as a tourist attraction, and right next to it, it's the nicest house in the whole community. In 1845, it was the nicest house in the community. In 2015, it's still the nicest house in the community. We've gone in one big ass circle. So when people start talking about progress, these white supremacists know what they're doing. We've gone in one big ass circle. I want y'all to visit that if y'all ever in Birmingham. If you're in Atlanta, drive over there. Yeah, that's what it's 331 Cotton Avenue. 331 Cotton Avenue, a plantation right dead in the hood. And I'm going to talk about a lot of these slave plantations that's still in operation around the country now. There's a lot of them that they use as tourist attractions. They try to hide the fact that they're slave plantations, but they're all over the place. And when I look at history, okay, I can't look at no videos right now, brother. Y'all putting up videos and I can't look at videos right now. But who's this? Yeah. But there are plantations and housing projects all over the place where plantations used to be. There's a place over in Charlotte. A lot of people are talking about Charlotte. There's a housing project. God damn it. I want to say Robert Mills. Anybody from Charlotte here? Where are my Charlotte people? I don't want to get the name wrong. Where are my Charlotte people? If somebody's from Charlotte is here, let yourself be known. Because I want to be correct. Let me turn my fan this way. Hold on. Shit. Hold on. Where are my Charlotte people? Where's Charlotte? Anybody from Charlotte in here? Charlotte, South Carolina, where all that stuff is going on up there. Where are my Charlotte people? Come on, I know some Charlotte people in here. Some people from... All right, Rock Hard. You from Charlotte, brother? Rock Hard. I'm not calling no nigga Rock Hard, man. What the fuck is your name? Get another screen name. I'm not about to call no nigga Rock Hard. The fuck this look like? An episode of Oz? Yeah, change your name. I ain't even about to address you, nigga. All right, let me see who else is... Let me see on the phone. What's up? Who's calling?
What's going on, Trick? This is Colby from Toronto.
Oh, okay. You sound like Rock Hard. Shit.
Yeah. I'm kind of sick.
No, did you came to the lecture in Detroit, right?
Yeah. I'm the guy with the bow tie.
Yeah, I remember you. I remember your voice, man. Shout out to this. This brother has a collection of bow ties, and I just got your bow ties upstairs. The bow ties are very nice, man. Let everybody know what your website is.
Yeah, my website's www.necktour.ca, and it's spelled NECKCOUTURE.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. So what's on your mind, man?
Not much. Just a quick question. Once in a while, I'll bump into females. They're good looking. They show me cooperation and everything, but I try and put them on game, like in terms of having an actual business mindset.
Yeah.
What do you do in a situation where you're trying to put a girl on game, get her in the right business mindset? I also have friends who are deep in a situation where they're trying to get their girls on in a business mindset and they have a kid with them, but they're not really thinking on that level. Like, what do you do in certain situations like that?
Well, the thing is, the problem is, see, y'all try to change the game in the ninth inning. You understand?
Yeah.
And what happens is you got to establish the game during training season. Meaning, when you date somebody or get into a relationship, you need to let them know early on what the protocol of the relationship is going to be. What happens is that y'all get into these relationships, y'all get with the women, y'all don't really set no standards and no protocols and no rules and no instructions, and then y'all just kind of let shit fly, and then y'all put on the simp hat, and then y'all simp for a minute, and then when you start getting business-minded, you want to start trying to get her to change. And she's like, wait, no, nigga, I'm used to dealing with you as a simp. So now it's like pulling teeth trying to change what you have established in the female. You feel me? So you got to establish early on what you want them to do, what you want the protocol to be, what you want her role to be in conjunction with what you got going on. So you got to let that be known early on. And you start the way you end. Just understand that phrase. You start how you end. So start on a business level. Y'all going to end on a business level. You feel me?
All right, that's what's up.
Much respect, man. That's my dude right there. That's why y'all need to check out the show Power. That's why y'all need to check out the show Power. Power has a lot of good game in it. Now, he's a black dude, by the way, the guy who just called. But y'all need to check out the TV show Power. Power is just hands down the best show on television. I absolutely love that show. If you can get the Stars Network, order the Stars Network just for that show. That is the best show on television. A lot of good game. Great, great show, man. I absolutely love that show. You dig? And there's a lot of ism in that show about how to handle your business. It's a lot of street shit, but it just shows you how business should be handled in relation to how you date. Because there's a lot of relationship intrigue, business intrigue, street intrigue. So you can learn a lot of shit. Oh, man, it kills Empire. And I like Empire. I like Empire, but it shits on Empire. Way better than Empire. And I like Empire, by the way. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Let's see who we got on the phone here. What's up? Who's calling?
Hey, King Flex. Yo, this is G calling out of Atlanta by way of New York.
Hey, what's up?
And, yo, I just wanted to... I'm sorry. Go ahead, please.
Go ahead, G. How you doing, fam?
I'm good. I'm good, man. Yo, I just want to say real quick, thank you for coming out. I enjoyed that Atlanta show.
Yes, sir.
Met a lot of cool people over there. Made a lot of good connects. Enjoyed the show all around. And I thank you for continuing to educate everybody on what's going on and how to really address the problems that we're dealing with as black people. So
yes, sir.
I'm going to let you go, bro. Thank you so much.
Much respect, man. Thanks for the call. Yeah, I really enjoyed Atlanta, man. We had a blast in Atlanta, man. We had a blast in Atlanta. And, you know, I went over to, when I was in Birmingham, I drove back over to Atlanta. I had to get some stuff done to the rental property I bought out there. And I had to get some work done. So I went down because I kept trying to find, and this is black folks, we need to start again. This is why I get on black folks about business. We got to be thorough about handling our business. We got to be real thorough about our business. See, we be fucking around a lot when it comes to handling business. Because I asked a lot of people, hey, what can I find some brothers who are carpenters? So people kept throwing names here and there, but not really, you know, couldn't really get in touch with the people. You dig? So I'm like, well, fuck it. Let me go old school. Let me go down to the Home Depot. I'll find somebody there. So I went to the Home Depot out there in Atlanta on Ponce. Right there on Ponce de Leon. And that's the pronunciation that you're supposed to use. I remember when I first went to Atlanta and I was pronouncing shit correctly, people act like they know what the fuck I was talking about. The name of the street is after a European explorer named General Ponce de Leon. That's like a French name. And that's the correct pronunciation is Ponce de Leon. Because I've been to France. I know a little France. I know a little Francais. So I'm saying that when I went down to Atlanta, I'm like, hey, excuse me, ma'am, how do I get over to Ponce de Leon? What? Okay, she must not know where it is. I'm like, excuse me, brother. I'm trying to get to Ponce de Leon. What you say, player? And I'm like, nigga, I'm looking for Ponce de Leon. I said, oh, look, I'm looking for this right here. Oh, Ponce de Leon. I said, okay, Ponce de damn Leon then. Shit. All right. So I learned everything ain't got to be extra proper. You dig? Make a right on Ponce. It's Spanish. Okay, I thought Ponce... It's Ponce de Leon. I thought he was, I could have sworn he was French. Hold on. Let's look that up right now. I'm going to get my history correct right now. I could have sworn Ponce de Leon was French. Hold on. Ponce de Leon. Hold on. Okay. He got to Puerto Rico. Spain. Okay, he was. Okay, he's Spanish. Okay. But the de Leon, that's a French. So he must have, his family must be from France or some shit. Hold on. Let me look him up. Okay. So he was a Spanish conquistador. Okay. Because I knew he had the whole Fountain of Youth thing. He came in from Florida and all that. But the name that Ponce de Leon, I hear that name in France. So, okay. My bad. It was Spanish. My bad. But that name, Ponce de Leon, that's like you hear that a lot in France. The Ponce of Leon. Yeah, oh, it sounds alike. Right, let me see who this is. What's up, who's calling?
Yo, Tariq, this is Jay from Chicago, man. What's good?
Hey, man, what's going on with you, fam?
Man, Joe, I'm 24 years old, right? And yes. I'm a hip-hop artist. So I'm having a little trouble establishing myself. But I don't know whether to focus on chasing my dreams, establishing myself, or combating white supremacy.
You can do both. Yeah, you can do both. There's nothing that says you can't do both. You can combat white supremacy and find out what your dream is, or reach for your dream or whatever you want to do. Now, what makes you think you can't do both?
Well, I just feel like I should put most of my energy into completing my dreams right now, fulfilling my dreams, and I don't know if I should just try to own my business at the same time or try to establish myself as an artist. I don't know where to put most of my energy.
Well, what you can do, man, you can really put yourself in a situation where you can build and do for yourself without starving. That's the name of the game. You don't want to have to starve trying to get your career off the ground. And you don't want to be a struggling artist out here and trying to get on and living at your mama's house till you 45 years old on no dumb shit. You understand what I'm saying?
So, right.
But you can always, again, handle yourself and take care of systematic white supremacy and understand it and try to maneuver around it, whatever you do, because even as an artist, that's something you're going to have to deal with. You deal with white supremacy at any avenue. So whether you want to or not, you're going to have to deal with it in the music industry, because when the white supremacists step up, they're going to have they a pen in one hand and their dick in the other. You dig?
So yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So you better know the game so you don't get fucked. You feel me?
Yes, sir. Thank you, man.
Thanks for the call, brother. Yeah, man. All right. Yeah, there's no escaping that, man. You better understand white supremacy in whatever you do, because you're going to run into it. Yeah, you're going to run into it, fam. So you better be on top of your game. A lot of folks are calling. Speaking of Chicago, you know, I saw a video earlier today where there was some kind of, I don't know, there was two people got killed in Chicago. I don't know if they got shot or if they were in a car accident, but I saw this video. I should have saved this video to play it on the show. But there were these people in Chicago. They got killed. I don't know how they got killed, but the car was towing them with the dead bodies in the car. And there were people in the neighborhood gathering around, and they were upset that these people were getting towed while they were dead in their car. No ambulance, no yellow tape, nothing. This was in Chicago. I think this happened either today or yesterday. I need to find the video to show y'all. This was in Chicago. Dude, this sounds like some shit where they're about to go take these people and get them organs. It sounded like they were about to go take them real quick and get them organs out real quick. They were like, damn the coroner. I mean, that shit was bold, man. Yeah, they told you. What's up, Maddie? That's right. They told the dead body with the, what they told the car with the dead body out the window. Matt, are you from Chicago? Because I want to know how the people got killed. That shit was crazy. Oh, yeah, Power is the show, man. Power is the best show on television, man, hands down. Power is that show. Yeah, Power's off the chain. This the video right here? Hold on one second. Let me download. Hold on. Let me see if I can download this video real quick, if this is it. Hold on one second, man. Okay, yeah, that's
it. How do you tow a car with a deceased body in? They are towing a car with a deceased body in.
Stay focused. They can't tow no motherfucking car with them in there. Why the fuck they towing the car with them in there? They can't tow that car with them in there.
See, this is neighborhood. This neighborhood is, I don't know how the people got killed or nothing, man, but the people are yelling. There's a big crowd out there. The cops are out there kind of antagonizing people. And they're towing a car with a dead body, with a couple of dead bodies in it. So, Midtown, do you know those people? Now, who knows what happened? Yes, Bobby Christina did die. Yes, she did. But them taking that them dead bodies out of there on towing them in a car? Dude, they about to take them to some warehouse and get them organs so fast. Nigga, that ain't nothing but organ trafficking right there. If they ain't waiting on a corner, they're taking dead. They're taking dead bodies off the streets without the coroner, without them going to the hospital, without the morgue ambulance. No, okay. Wow. That's heavy shit. Y'all saw that situation down in Lafayette, Louisiana, where that white supremacist shot up the movie theater. Yes, Lady B, I talked about that earlier. Police, two dead, one hurt. Hold on. So somebody was shot, okay? So you're moving to Botswana. We'll talk about that in a minute. But the shooting down in Lafayette, Louisiana, this dude shot up a movie theater. If y'all follow me on Twitter, the night that shooting happened in Louisiana, I said on Twitter, I said, look, when this comes out, if y'all go back and look at my timeline, I said, I bet y'all this dude is connected or is a white supremacist or white extremist. I said that repeatedly, even before they announced that dude's name. John Hauser, something like that, that's his name. But even before they didn't announce his name until like the next day, I think. But hours before they announced the dude's name, before they knew who he was, I said, that's going to be a white supremacist. He's going to be connected to a white supremacist organization. He's going to be at least connected to white supremacist ideology. I already knew. Sure enough, and the trolls were going at me. The white supremacist trolls were so mad at me. Oh, how dare you bring race into this? Oh, you a race baiter. Oh, you're race baiting. Then when they announced his name, all the articles came out showing that this dude was a straight-up white supremacist. He was a Hitler supporter. He was a Hitler sympathizer. I think they said he had a Confederate flag in front of his house. I mean, he was just straight up and down. Now, I knew it was going to be a white supremacist or a white extremist. I knew. Not because I'm psychic, because I understand patterns. And the thing is, the media, and it's run by white supremacists, they deliberately act dumb when it comes to white supremacy. But when it's a black person doing something crazy, they tie us into every damn body. They tie in the Crips, Bloods. Y'all remember when the black dude shot those two cops in New York? Oh, it was the Black Gorilla Family, the Baltimore Bloods, the Oakland Crips. It was Keith Sweat, Salt and Pepper. It was the First AME Church. Everybody was damn involved in that nigga shooting them cops. They name every black organization they could name, and then they wheel black people out one by one to apologize. Well, we sorry. All of us ain't like that, nah. But when these people shoot up these theaters, shoot up these churches, oh, they're just lone wolves. He was a lone wolf. Wasn't no damn lone wolf when you have a whole bunch of people with the same damn ideology. It's the same people with the same, a group of people with the same ideology, white extremist mentality. And this is the second time a movie theater has been shot up in the last couple of years. And what's interesting, they ain't making the producers and the actors of the movie apologize. You notice that? Because y'all remember when New Jack City and Boys in the Hood and all that shit came out? Whenever there was any violence around the theater, they would blame the film itself. They would blame New Jack City. They would blame John Singleton for making Boys in the Hood. They would have to come out and apologize. They would blame the actors for theater shootings when it's black folks. The Last Snowman. What I'm going to do now is ban you. Last Snowman, I'm going to have to ban you, brother. And Last Snowman, if you want to call up and say what you got to say, the number is 818-850-5404. It's my sister. What my sister say? Oh, yeah, they always do. My sister said they always do the lone wolf drifter. But the thing is, you notice with these white supremacists and most of these mass shootings, if you look at them, they're carried out by people with a white extremist mentality. These people who be on these websites like Stormfront and all that, and the media ignores all of that shit. Elliot Rodger had white supremacist views when he did his little shooting. The Columbine shooters, those were little white supremacists. Dylan Roof, white supremacist. This guy here from the other night shooting up at the theater, he had white supremacist views. So why do they just ignore these dudes who have the same ideology? They act like they're lone wolves and they all have this anti-black ideology. This whole white supremacist view of life. See, that's why, family, you can't look at everything and take everything you get from the media for face value. The media is in on this stuff, man. A lot of the media outlets, man, they're the propaganda arm for white supremacy. This is why they protect the white supremacist soldiers and martyrs. So understand, white supremacists is a religion and it's a business. And in the business, you have the race soldiers, which are the police, or people who work with the police department and infiltrate it as race soldiers, because not all police are race soldiers. Being a cop ain't bad. Being a race soldier is bad. So you have the race soldiers. Then you have the propaganda machine, which is the media. They give out the propaganda and they protect the race soldiers. Then you have the martyrs for white supremacy. You got the people to go out and do the suicide missions, like the Dylan Roofs and the guy, the old man who shot up the theater. Because look at how they describe these guys. See, they protect these guys with their words. They protect them with their words. Well, he's mentally unstable. He's a lone wolf. He's a drifter. He's just a helpless old man who didn't know what he was doing. He's old. Or if it's a kid, Dylan Roof is 22. He's a child who didn't know any better. Let's just buy him some Burger King. They're buying Dylan Roof Burger King like he's a little toddler. They're buying him Happy Meals like he's a little baby. He just shot up a bunch of people. Oh, yeah, Timothy McVeigh, another one. Oh, yeah, the list goes on and on. I mean, I can go on just down the list. Oh, Timothy McVeigh, of course. Oh, most of them are. But they protect them. They protect them with their words. They protect these race soldier police. They go with the, well, he was afraid for his life narrative. And then they criminalize the black victim. They always do that. You never see these media outlets criminalizing white victims of anything. They never criminalize white victims. Even if a white victim shoots himself or get killed, they don't criminalize him. If there's a white supremacist who goes out and shoots up a place and then ends up getting killed, there was a shooting out here in Studio City. Right after the shooting in Louisiana. Out here in California, there was a shooting in Studio City where a dude, white dude, just went out and just starts outside of Chipotle, just start busting shots. And then the cops came and shot him because he wouldn't put his gun down. Right now, this was a few days ago. I don't think they released his name yet. The media, they have not released that dude's name yet, and you won't hear shit about that story no more. They can't. Who they were? There was going to be a protest at an officer's home. Let me get this. Let me see who's calling. What's up? Who's calling?
Hey, how you doing? This is Don calling out of Little Rock, Arkansas.
Hey, what's up, Don? How you doing, fam?
I'm good. I'm good. Got a quick question, and I'm going to let you go.
Go ahead.
I understand you're not really big on the whole right versus left thing, but under the context of me asking the question, I apologize for using it.
Okay.
But what do you think, what has been this influx of what you call YouTube coons, or whether they're, I mean, they're just coming out the woodwork,
yeah.
And why is that? I just want to... Get your explanation on that, and thank you for taking my call.
Yeah, thank you, man. They're coming out the woodworks because the white supremacists are getting more violent now, and the coons are getting scared. So instead of saying, hey, man, we need to do something about white supremacy, these coons are throwing in the towel and trying to be guard dogs for white supremacy. They're trying to get like a little place under white supremacy to be safe. That's all that is. These are just niggas cooning to be safe. Because they're scared. They are basically domesticated animals. You dig? They're domesticated animals. Okay, we got some trolls in the room. So what I'm going to do... I'm going to... get rid of some of the trolls in the room... So what I'm going to do, I'm making Miss Aki a mod right now so Aki can start hitting up some of these trolls when they start getting a little crazy. Because there's... How many people in the room right now, family? How many people in the room? How many people in the room? Now, Sikari, whatever your name, I don't see what his posts are. Some people say he's trolling. It's so many people in here. I can't actually see what he's saying. Okay, there you go. I'm against white supremacists, neo-Nazis. Oh, black supremacists. Oh, okay, I see what he's saying. Okay, so Sakari, I need you to call up. Let's not, don't ban Sakari. He asked a question. I understand that. Now, Sakari, I need you to call up. We're in here heavy. We almost got 2,000 people in here. So let me have Sakari. Sakari, can you call up, please? What's up? Who's calling?
This is Dana.
Dana?
Damon.
Where you calling from, Damon?
I'm calling from Seattle, Washington.
Now, what's on your mind?
Man, I was just wondering, what did you feel like with currency connected in your body and people getting healthy and understand that you got to be healthy before you can start getting your currency right?
Okay, so people got to get their currency together in their body?
Yes, it's all energy, so I was just trying to aware people that while everybody's trying to get money, you got to take care of your body first if you can get anything done.
Okay, so how do you get the currency together in your body?
Well, first you got to clean out your body.
Okay.
And the concern with me is like with black people and what they eating. I don't think they realize a lot of bad foods is manifesting in their whole lives.
Okay. There you go. All right, man. Well, thank you for the call, brother. My man said you got to get your currency right in your body. Okay, I can't disagree with that. It's, my man sound like he smoked a little something, but it's okay. My man sound like he smoked him something good. All right, let's see who this is. What's up? Who's calling?
Hey, Tariq, how are you? This is Kwani calling from Cleveland.
Hey, Kwani, how are you, love?
How are you? I'm good.
What's going on with the family out there?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
I said, what's going on with the family out there? How's Samaria?
She's doing. We got a couple of situations where I don't want to talk about that online because we're still going through some court stuff and all of this.
Right.
But
now, by the way, this is a relative of Tamir Rice right here, for those who don't know. Yes.
Yeah, I'm his second cousin.
Yes, indeed.
His mother's my first cousin.
Right. So what's going on now?
Okay, I just have a question for you. I'm a newly licensed massage therapist, right?
Yeah.
So I just need to know, how do I get through? Like, I have two jobs now. I work at the clinic, but my main job is at a massage studio. And it's like, a lot of the, I would call them white supremacists, because they're like when I try to do things, they try to sabotage you. Like they'll try to book me with clients back to back to back.
Yeah.
And they know I'm trying to start my own business. And in about 3 months, I'm going to actually leave my one job and take money out of my 401k and start my own, actually get my own shop.
Yeah.
But now I'm like building clients, and it's like, they see me doing good, and I make and sell lotion, soaps, and candles and stuff like that, and I sell them.
Okay.
And it's like, they see me doing good, and they try to, you know, like, they'll take an appointment for me, and then say, oh, we can write it down in the book, or, you know, just like all kind of stuff that's preventable. They're trying to sabotage you because they know that I'm leaving, you know, after a while.
And that's the problem. And that's the problem.
What can I say?
Listen. Okay, and that's the problem. They know you're leaving. Don't tell these white supremacists you about to bounce and get your own shit going. Y'all got black folks, we make a big mistake of telling everybody what the fuck we gonna do. Don't tell them that. Don't tell them shit.
Yeah.
You shouldn't have told
them. But it is. I tell my client, you know, my clients, because my clients, I want to take them with me.
Right.
I can do that because they won't see anyone but me.
Exactly.
But for now, I don't have an actual shop. Yeah. I have to go, like you said, use them until I don't need them anymore. So I have to basically use their shop. So I have to tell my clients, you know, in 3 months I'll have my own.
Yes, indeed.
And
so what you got to do, you got to chill on that. And when you start getting your shit popping, or getting it close to popping, then you start weaning those new clients over. But they're going to sabotage you, knowing that ultimately you going to bounce. So what they're going to do, it's like, okay, since we're going to have to sell this slave in a month, we're going to give this slave extra work. That's what they would do on plantation.
You're right.
You did?
Right.
That's what they're going to double up on your ass. That's why they're overbooking you. They're going to make you do all types of shit. They're going to get every damn dime out of your ass they can get. All the work possible. Because they know you bouncing, and they're going to work you like a mule, and they're going to sabotage you. So you should have been real cool and low-key with what you were going to do.
Right.
Keep your mouth shut.
And that's what they do, because they know when I leave there, I go to my night job, because I work overnight at the Cleveland Clinic. So
yes, indeed.
That's what they do.
But thank you for the call, Q. Thank you, love.
Okay.
Dude, y'all got to stop doing that, man. When you got a plan, don't tell everybody what you got going on. Don't tell everybody what you got going on, man. Because, see, I see white dudes who work at some of these production companies out here. They work at these production companies, and they'll laugh and joke, and everything is cool, and then one day, they ain't there no more. The one day, they got a whole new studio somewhere on the other side of town. You don't know shit until they got it open. You don't know nothing until they got it open. They move in silence, dude. They sit up, they'll sit up and make plans like, hey, man, you know, over here at Warner Brothers, man, you know, I got a whole bunch of movies I'm doing, man. I'm working on 8 movies, 3. And then I call them the next week. Oh, yeah, I left Warner Brothers, man. I'm over here at DreamWorks, and I got a whole new project. Like, damn. So they move in silence. They ain't telling you shit until the shit is done. And they'll keep up a good face. We be telling everybody everything we gonna do. We gotta stop that and start ear hustling and hustling the game and getting more information. Yeah, you gotta be careful on that. And those clients you giving massages to, you need to have your cards ready, hitting them up, letting them know on the low, hey, I'm gonna be bouncing pretty soon, but this is for you. Or just give them that. You gotta be slick with it. Oh, Aki, let me remod you, Aki. Make moderator. Okay? Make mod. Okay, you should be remodded, Aki. So where's the dude, the guy, six something? I wanted him to call up. What's up? Who's calling?
Tariq Nasheed.
Hey, what's up? Who's this?
Abner from Avalon Gardens.
Okay. What's going on, man? What you doing out there in Avalon Gardens, fam?
I have a question. How does a black independent filmmaker get funding?
Usually it's from investors, but now you have things like Kickstarter and Indiegogo, so that's a good bet right now. That's the greatest thing for a black independent filmmaker right now, the crowdfunding sources. That's the number one thing right now. So what you got to do, you got to put together a real good project, and if it's good enough, people will gravitate towards it. What kind of films you got planned?
I actually want to do a movie about Jack Johnson.
Oh.
The former first black heavyweight boxing champion of the world.
Yes, indeed, man. Jack Johnson was the dude. Now you want to do it as a documentary? What are you trying to do it as?
An actual small budget movie about him.
Oh, okay. Yeah, man. You get that going and you can get it popping. Now, how long have you been doing films?
I've actually just been acting. This is my first attempt trying to do my own type of movie.
Okay. So you've been just doing like extra work or what?
I actually did a supporting role. I already did my first supporting role. I'm now trying to step into the limelight, you know, get more recognition.
Right.
I haven't been doing extra work.
Okay, so what supporting role were you in?
A movie, Walking Through Los Angeles.
Okay.
By Todd Debrecast.
Now, when did you do that?
Just in 2014.
Okay. Now, you from L.A. originally?
Oh, no, I'm from Miami.
Okay, now how long you been in L.A.? What the hell are you doing in Avalon Gardens, man, from Miami? That's a hell of a culture change, dude.
I know, man.
What the fuck are you doing in Avalon Gardens?
You know, it just coming to California, there's just so much more opportunities up here than back home in Florida, you know, meeting stars, you know, famous people.
Now, have the Pyrus tried to get at you?
What?
Have them Pyrus tried to get at you out there?
Nah, man.
Man, but just keep doing your thing, man. How old are you? You sound like a young dude.
I'm actually 28.
Okay. Okay, cool.
Yeah, hey, man, I just turned 28.
Okay, all right, but again, just Kickstarter or something like that, that would be good. That would be a good start for you. And actually, I got a clip of one of the movies you were in right here. This is some of your acting right here, brother, right here. Hold on.
They're eating her. And then they're going to eat me. Oh, my God.
All right, my man's going to get an Oscar for that. All right. Yeah, my man was all over the place with it. What was your support? All right, I gave Scary the number. The number is 818-850-5404. That's the number. All right, so call up, dude. What's his name? The dude who had the question about black supremacy? Call up. Let's talk about that. All right, what's up? Who's calling?
What's up, Ritter, man? This T out of North Carolina.
What's up, T? What's on your mind, man?
Well, man, I'm just working, and I'm wondering what I'm trying to do is get to that point where I can just be like, all right, I had enough working at the steel mill because I can't do that forever, and just being able to start a business and then just live off that, you know, just find investment and whatnot still, too, and then teach the young brothers how to do it.
Yeah. Well, what you got to do, man, you start small, man. You start weaning yourself off the job, start stacking your money. That's one thing.
I'm a real, I know how to maneuver money. My dad taught me, so.
Yes, indeed. Yeah, just, you know, stack your money up and then start figuring out what you're good at and what you like to do, what your passion is. That's the number one thing. Well, let me get some more calls. Thanks for the call. I want to get some more calls. I don't want to get too caught up here. All right, that's my sister. Love you, Tia. Good night, sis. My sister going to sleep right now. All right, where the dude with the questions. If I don't want to have to block him, but if you don't call up, man, if you don't call up in the next 2 minutes, I'm just going to block you, dude. What number are you calling from? Skilla, Skitty, whatever. Sakari, that's your name. Sakari, what area code you calling from? Because you got 2 seconds to call up. That trolling, you're not going to troll in here all night. That's not going to happen. That shit playing dumb where you don't know the number and all that stupid shit. Sakari, you're going to have to call up, man. Just ban Sakari. Okay, I'm going to ban him. I'll ban him. Sakari, I'm just going to ban you. So now if you want to interact, you're going to have to just call up anyway. If I find your troll-ass name, hold on. There's so many people in here. It's so many people in here, it's kind of difficult. There you go. I'm going to ban that ass right now. There you go. So Sakari, I ban you, brother. You on the bans list, player. Alright. Okay, what's this whole thing about Botswana? Y'all keep talking about Botswana. What's happening with Botswana? Gokira, what's up with you and Botswana, brother? Because you're just going on and on about Botswana. He said his area code is 650. Okay. Well, I'm waiting on him to call up if he's going to call up. All right. Now, he can call him. I banned him, but he has to call up now. So. Yeah, he's going to have to call up. Hold on 1 second. Alright, let's see who this is. What's up, who's calling?
Hey, this is Rob from Pittsburgh.
Rob from, oh wait, hold on, wait. I'm going to have you call back, Rob. I have you call back. Hold on. Let's see if this is him. Hold on, this might be somebody else. Bullshit, no. What's up? Hello?
He's called up.
Hello?
Yes.
Now, who is this?
This is Tariq.
Okay, this nigga sounds retarded already. What's up, man? Who is this?
Is this Tariq?
Nigga, who is this? Stop playing on the phone, you raggedy bastard.
My name's Sakari.
You Sakari?
Yes.
Okay, why you sound like you got a feather in your ass?
I got a what?
A feather in your ass. Why you sound like you just about to bust out laughing?
I'm not about to bust out laughing.
Now, what are you calling?
I'm 72 years old. I don't play any games.
You're 72?
Yes.
Okay. Now, where are you from?
Half Moon Bay, California.
Okay. Now, how'd you find my show?
I was going through Ustream, stepping down the channels, trying one after another that looked interesting. I saw yours. I gave it a shot. It sounded pretty interesting. Okay. So what I noticed during all of your talk with various callers or just talking was a very narrow communication. Oh. It wasn't obviously, you have a fan base and you have your own people you're talking to, and I expect that would be the case. But there's no mention by any of the callers of any of the equivalencies. Now, you should know off the top, I'm not in favor of white supremacists. In fact, I've been a victim of them. I'm Portuguese, and my skin color is in between black and white. And although I'm technically white, I've often been the victim of prejudice.
How have you been the victim?
My calling is simply to ask you about the equivalent of the Black Hebrew Israelites, the Moorish scientists, people, those people that are harassing everyone, whether they're white or any other color that's not black,
right.
They're putting them down. and then they're claiming all this stuff of backgrounds that are totally fictitious.
Okay, now let me address that. Now, Sakar, let me address you. Now you classified as white. You are classified as white, right?
Yes.
Yes, indeed. So you said, how come we don't address the equivalency of white supremacy, which is the Moore Science Temple?
More so the Black Hebrew Israelite.
Right. Okay. Now let's stop there, sir. There is no equivalent black racism from any of those groups because all they do is name call. White supremacy don't call names. They do action. So there is outside of them calling you names or just running their mouths,
they don't call me names.
Or anybody names, sir. Outside of name calling of any of these groups you name, please show me the equivalent of black supremacy where they have actually done any type of harm, disenfranchisement, or subjugation of anybody white. Name any instance.
Okay, I'll answer you.
Yes.
They don't. And I'm not trying to make an equivalency between them.
You just
I'm
did, sir. I'm
trying to make a comparison about the mental state, the mindset of hatred for other races.
We don't know, sir. Black people don't really care about your mindset. We care about the actions that the white supremacists inflict on us. We care about Sandra Bland being killed. We care about Tamir Rice being killed. We care about being gentrified out of our neighborhood.
That's a subjective view. I'm trying to be objective here. I'm caught in the middle, probably less in the middle. I'm closer to average Caucasians than I am black. But I still see myself as not a white person, but a Caucasian. There's a difference in my mind.
Oh, really?
Many Caucasians only see you by your skin color. And like I said, I had a girlfriend who wouldn't let me even go to her house to meet her father because I was too dark.
Okay.
So I've been a victim of that part. But
let me stop there. Sir, you've been a victim of that probably in the early 1930s, because you're 70 years old, so you were born in 1930 or 40? No, you were born in 1945. 43, okay, you were born in the...
43, and my experiences weren't until the 50s.
Right, because at that time, a lot of people who were Portuguese and Spanish and Italian, they were just allowed into whiteness at that time, okay? So they were allowed into full whiteness. I understand the history, but once they became allowed, they became staunch white supremacists. So now a lot of Italian Americans are big time white supremacists.
You're right.
Yes, indeed.
But that's not the general nature. I lived in North Beach, San Francisco, which was all Italian. I'm not Italian, but I'm close enough.
Yeah, I know.
The guys in the beach. Guys you'd call gangsters, and I was one of them.
Uh-huh.
We never talked about blacks whatsoever. There wasn't one black guy came in the beach one night and started saying we were calling ourselves spook beaters. And we were stupefied because we never discussed that at all. Not part of our thinking. We just get along. Go ahead.
Now, when did that happen? That happened within the 1950s? That had to happen because that's...
That was in the late 60s. Mid and late 60s.
Because that's why a lot of black gangs got started, actually, because white supremacist groups were going around calling themselves spook beaters, and they were beating up black people all over California. And
we weren't them.
But they didn't know that at the time.
We called those guys the Barn Boys.
Uh-huh.
They were country. They were in South San Francisco, and they would come into the beach, and we had fights with them.
But we weren't on
one side or the other. We don't consider ourselves a racial identity. We consider ourselves an ethnic identity.
But the thing is, when it comes down to race, many of those people who are Portuguese and Spanish, they fall right in line with white supremacy when they need to fall in line with it. And they have not stopped.
No one I knew did. Only some old timers that had their own prejudices. But we just got along. We didn't have that much interaction, frankly. There weren't many blacks in North Beach. It was all Italian. And the mob was running.
Well, there was a reason why there were no black. But there was a reason why, because black folks weren't allowed to live in that area, sir. All over California. California is home to a lot of sundown towns. So there's a reason why black people weren't allowed to live in those areas. They weren't in that area, not by choice, because the white supremacists wouldn't let them in there.
You say not allowed. Let me explain a little more. North Beach was all Italian. Despite its ethnic diversity, was pretty much all Italian. A few Irish, I think, were there. But even Chinese, which we got along with perfectly well, they never came out there because it wasn't their area. By the end of the 60s, Chinese took over North Beach.
Because the white supremacists allowed them to.
There were no fist fights involved. It was a matter of people preferring where they wanted to live. But to live in North Beach, you had to have family there because nobody could afford to live there. I couldn't afford. The only reason I was there was I ran away from home when I was 15 years old, and that's where I ended up. I was on the streets for years.
But what about all the black people who were not allowed to live in certain cities in California?
Absolutely. I defend your position on that. I defend your position very strongly on the white supremacists. I'm fighting those people on the internet all the time. They try to get me to be one of them when they don't even know what I look like, much less what I think.
But y'all ain't fighting hard enough. Y'all haven't stopped the white supremacists. Y'all are not stopping these white supremacists. Y'all are not fighting hard enough, brother.
You can't stop people with that mindset by simple conversation.
Exactly. So what do you need to do to stop white supremacists instead of just making excuses?
Physical and political action. And I'm not against what you're saying. All I'm trying to say when I called you was to try to point out that there's equivalents that don't have anything to do with blacks wanting to be treated fairly and justly. They have a plan, just like the Islamic that want to take over the world with their ideology.
But what
it's not going to happen, but it's very threatening.
But what you need to do, sir, don't focus on people like the Nation of Islam or the Hebrew Israelites. These are people who are victims of white supremacy. Doing only thing they can do is verbally lash out. They're just verbally lashing out against a system that is unjust and evil. So instead of you addressing your energy to the victims of white supremacy, all of your energy, sir, should be going to the white supremacists. You feel me?
Okay, I hear you. And what I'm hearing from you is an apologist viewpoint, which means you dismiss the very hatred that they're exuding. And they're not exuding it to white supremacists. They're exuding it to the average person that's not along with their thinking.
You say apologists?
So, we can agree on one part, and that's that we're both against white supremacy and beyond the white supremacy, the government. I'm not with this government at all.
But white supremacists run the government. You're still talking about white supremacy. The white supremacists run the government, all right? There's no black people running the government, including Obama. So we're still talking about white supremacists. So you keep trying to deflect away from white supremacy, sir.
Oh, no, I'm not. I'll dwell on it if you want.
There we go.
I'm one of the people that's fighting this business with the Confederate flag and the mentality of Caucasians trying to align themselves with Christianity and the Republican Party. I'm watching all the games being played because I grew up doing nothing but watching games go on.
There you go.
It didn't matter who it was coming from. So my mindset is watching what's going on.
All right. Thank you for the call. All right. There you go. I'm done. I ain't going to let this motherfucker just babble and deflect all night. I was trying to be as respectful as possible. All right, but I'm just not going to let somebody babble in denial all night. All right, I'll let you talk, bruh. I was respectful. But you're not going to really do nothing with white supremacy, bro. And that's a liberal white supremacist, a suspected white supremacist. See, my thing is this, family. Just because y'all remember on my lecture tour, I talked about this. If y'all came to the code of conduct tour, I warned people about the liberal white supremacists who act like, oh, I'm not like those white supremacists over there. You see that? See, oh, I'm not when I don't know why the black folks weren't over here in this part of San Francisco where they funneled all the black people over to Oakland and the hood and all right, man, we can go all deep into that. But he was playing the liberal white supremacist role. The, oh, I'm not racist. The Nation of Islam and the Morris Science Temple and the Hebrew, they're the racist. That's the equivalent. That's, how come you don't talk about the equivalent racism? I said, okay, well, sir, outside of name calling, point to any type of equal racism coming from any of those people. I can't. Okay, don't get that. Well, that wasn't hard. So I'm not going to complain about some people over here just running their mouths. What do I got to say about them? They're just talking. They're just running their mouths. And then he tried to go into the whole ethnic thing. Well, I'm Portuguese and I'm barely white. I'm Portuguese and I'm kind of dark. And here they go. They use the same shit. That's the whole, well, I'm 185th Native American, so I'm minority too. So I'm one of you guys. It's that bullshit. Come on, man. It's that shit. The white supremacists are funny. This is why black people, sometimes you gotta know when to not allow the white supremacists to run you on a time-wasting trip. That's why you got to understand. Don't let the white supremacists waste your time. Don't let them waste your time. I see Jeff is spamming. I'm trying to block Jeff, and I can't block his dumb ass. Oh, yeah. Oh, and I could have went into the whole, I'm like, we're going to do the whole, I'm not, I don't have anything against the black, I'm Portuguese. And they were some of the first damn people enslaving folks. Oh, I could have went there. I could have talked about how they brought so many damn Africans to Brazil. That's why you got a damn large ass country of people of African descent speaking Portuguese in Brazil. They were some of the original slave owners. The Portuguese were some of the first ones over in Africa enslaving people. The whole I'm Portuguese, so I'm kind of one of you. All right. Yeah, I didn't want to get too deep with him because he was so in denial. Oh, he was so in denial, and he was playing the I don't know, I'm naive, I got Alzheimer's, I don't know. He knows what's up. He ain't dumb. It's the government. Oh, don't start that government shit. Here we go. Here we go. Don't start that. It's the government. Oh, the Portuguese, well, they one of the first people who started slavery. All right? Well, I'm kind of dark. Yeah. They had so many damn Africans down in Brazil. But yeah, you one of us though, okay. Yeah, you barely white, all right. That barely white didn't stop them Portuguese slave ships from going back and forth. That barely white didn't stop that. Ayatollah, yeah, you can call up. What's going on, who's calling? Hello?
Hey, what's up, Flex? You King Flex?
It's me. What's up? Who's this?
Oh, what's up, King Flex? This is EJOC 100.
What's up? You from Vegas?
Yeah, this is from Vegas, man.
What's up,
like,
man?
I listen to the show. I haven't been listening to like 3 weeks, but I'm just coming in and saying what's up with you. I want to give you a big shout out. I have a lot of respect for you, man. You woke me up, man. I got all the hidden colors. I got all the t-shirts, all the books.
Yes, sir, man. Much respect to that, man. What's on your mind?
Yeah, really, I'm just calling you much respect. Like, I was listening to the guy who just called, and he was deflecting because, like, all those names, the Portuguese, all those names, they were all created by the European after colonization.
Oh, yeah.
So it was a lot of them, they like to deflect or whatnot.
And I learned a lot of stuff from you. I just want to give you a big shout out. I'm kind of nervous. I'm stepping on my words. That's all I wanted to say.
No problem, man. Thank you for the call, brother. Yes, indeed. But see, that's the thing, man. Don't let the white supremacists waste your time. That's another thing. They will call and deflect and troll and deflect, and even the so-called liberal ones. And that's a good lesson, because that guy, the older gentleman, 72 years old. So, you know, he has a whole life, a history of deflecting. He was like, well, some black people accused me of being spook hunters, and I wasn't no spook hunter, and I knew what he was talking about. You know, because he's going through his whole life of denying racism and white supremacy, being the liberal white person, but you still, you know, benefit from that system. As a dark Portuguese, you still benefit from white supremacy, and you know it. They try to deny it. But yeah, those segregated gangs and segregated neighborhoods out here in California, that was because of the housing laws. That's still in effect, to be honest. Some of the housing laws are still in effect. Now, when he was growing up, when the older gentleman called up, when he was growing up, they were blatant about these housing discrimination laws. They would have on the leases that black folks could live in certain areas. So all that naive Alzheimer's shit, I ain't buying it. And again, the spook hunters, that's why those gangs got started. That's why black street gangs got started, because you had white gangs who called themselves spook hunters, and they would run up on brothers. And that's why you had people like the Black Panthers forming in the Bay and down south, to get not only the law enforcement off of them, but some of these roving white supremacist gangs. Real deep stuff. But I'm glad he called, because that puts a lot of history in perspective. If he would have been a very good caller if he just wasn't going out of his way to deflect. I would like to have get him to bring more light on the history of some of the white supremacy, but he's such in denial about so much shit. You can get some information, then he goes on another 20 minutes about how he ain't like that. Stop it. Jeff, what's up, Jeff? Don't ignore Jeff. Jeff has some kind of program on his phone or his computer where we can't ban his stupid ass. So we're just going to have to ignore Jeff. And it's a lot of people in here, so I can't even see Jeff's tweets or Jeff's post. What's up? Who's calling?
Yes, brother. This is Tahuti's friend from the Ninth Street. I had a question, brother. This white man that just got hired at my job, he comes in automatically talking about, I love black women. I mean, is that a sign that this brother is...
you are now tuning in to the King of Games.
Is it a sign he's what now?
Is that a sign he's an undercover white supremacist?
It might be, brother. It just might be. Let's see who this is. Hold on. What's up? Who's calling?
Yep. Yeah.
Yo.
Hello?
What's up, man? Who is this? All right. Yeah, that nigga was clearly trolling with his voice, that bad acting. His acting was horrible. Hey, brother, this nigga been watching episodes of Starsky and Hutch. What's up? Who's calling?
Hey, what's going on, Tariq?
What's up? Who's this, man?
All right, this is not this Jersey. Hey, listen, there were two things I want to talk about. First, I want to say, what do we do for the Stephen A. Smith? Because, you know, when I've seen him pulling fats out his ass on his show, talking about, you know, majority of the domestic violence cases were black, you know, and he just was like, black. I mean, if I could have grabbed him through the screen, I would have. So, I mean, what do we do?
You know what, the thing with Coons, man, black people, this is why we need an economic base. Because with your economic base, you can reward or you can punish people. And other groups, they have an economic base. So there's people cooning within their society. They can punish them or reward them economically. Since we don't have an economic base, we become totally dependent on the white supremacists. There is no negative outcome for a person cooning. Only reward. And the white supremacists will give you, they'll give you a couple of crumbs for bug dancing. And we don't offer anything for people who really bring the truth or really represent. For example, like with The Hidden Colors, even that's the most popular documentary series ever. But you still have Negroes out here that will go out of their way to bootleg it and all that dumb shit to sabotage it. So that will discourage a lot of people from saying, okay, why should I do something for people who are just going to try to sabotage me anyway, and there's no mechanism to punish the saboteurs, but if I get up here and buck dance and coon for the white supremacists, at least I can get a job for life. And that's how Stephen A. Smith... So it's the whole plantation mentality all over again. This is why we got to learn how to be free blacks to a certain degree.
Right. Hey, you know what, Tariq, before you hang up, it was just on a funny note. I mean, I was on Twitter and I was getting trolled by your number one fan, the Dennis guy. So I said, you know what, man, since you trolling, I'm about to troll you back. So
yes,
indeed. You know, I just basically going back and forth with him. And I said, obviously, you can't be getting no women. He said, I'm about to go on a date right now. So I uploaded this picture. I said, not with that big ass face. And, you know, ain't no chick choosing on you. Yeah, but it was real funny, though. All right, Tariq.
Thanks for the call, man. Yeah, he's too pathetic to even ridicule. Ennis, he's so pathetic and sad. It's like, he's too pathetic to ridicule. All right, let's see who we got here. What's up, who's calling?
Hey, what's up, Tariq? This is Arlen from Washington, D.C.
Hey, man, what's on your mind, fam?
Hey, I'm good. Man, I have a question, man. Is it okay, you know, is there a problem dating, is there a problem between, all right, I'm 40.
All right.
And I'm dating a young lady, she's 27.
All right.
Is there a problem with that?
Hell no. What the hell problem is that?
Man, her parents think it's a problem. They say it's too big of an age gap.
Man, please, that woman is damn near 30.
So, that's what I said.
Yeah, this woman is 30, so her parents need to be out of her damn business, number one. So, right. You know, they're trying to baby this woman, and, you know, she's getting some miles on her. Shit. She's pushing 30, and you ain't no spring chicken. You dig? You better get in where you fit in. And does she have any kids or anything?
Man, nah, she ain't got no children. She's sweet. That's why I want to hold on to.
There you go, man. And is she cooperating?
Man, she cooperating. Look, I'm in Washington, D.C., and she lives in Kansas City, Missouri.
Yeah.
She recently just visited because her cousin had a little shindig, and she wanted to come. And so she stayed with me for the entire week.
Yeah.
So this is second visit. Last time she visited was back in April.
Oh, cool.
And we've been keeping it for like 4 years because she had lived down in Houston. Then she moved back to Kansas City. But she's originally from here. You dig what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah. So you've been, get that. And if she's cool like that, wipe that on up and, man, keep it macking with her. But don't let her parents try to sabotage the relationship with all that dumb shit.
It's just not her parents. It's her cousin who threw the party. And her uncle's from down Alabama.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, don't worry about the family and all that. As long as she's cooperating, that's all that matters. You dig? And if she's cooperating with you and she's feeling you, that's all that matters, bro. All right?
Man, that's a lot of you, man. Thank you.
Thanks for the call. Yeah, man. Shit, you got you a woman, 27, no kids, no miles on her. You get that. If you 40, shit. If you 50, get that. Shit. Make it happen. Let's see. We got somebody from Detroit calling. What's up? Who's calling?
Hey, what's up? This is Corey.
What's up, Corey?
Hey, what's good, man? I wanted to ask you a question, of course. I wanted to know, do you think that we have any allies, like, around the world? Is there anybody who really cares about African Americans?
We could get allies, but the thing is, we don't reach out to get them, though, bro. We could get a lot of allies, but we don't travel like we should. We don't reach out, and a lot of black folks don't stand up for themselves like they should, especially when they're in high positions, because what happens is that you get in high positions because usually the white supremacists. So a lot of us are not independently in a high position, which we got to learn how to be. And a lot of us are not, like we used to, not speaking out against injustice. So a lot of times when you look at the national media or the international media, who do you see? You see Stephen A. Smith. You see Charles Barkley. You see what about black on black crime? You see all these niggas buck dancing in the mainstream media, and that's by design. So we really got to start calling out the coon train and the bedwinch train and let people worldwide know that, hey, we want to link up with you and be allies with you. And we want to, you got to get out here and travel and then link up with people that way too. So traveling is very important, man. I can't emphasize.
Right, right. I noticed that. I noticed that we don't speak out enough, especially about the treatment. Like yeah. When you have a majority city like Detroit,
yeah.
When you have the majority of black people, but then you have somebody who can easily outsource, move you out, buy everything, then take back control. Like, I don't think that should be, that's not cool.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. All right, man, but thank you for the call, fam.
All right,
no
thanks.
Doubt. Yep. No doubt, no doubt. Let's see who we got here. Okay, let me see. Okay, I think this one white supremacist call now. Hold on one second. 818-850-5404. Hold on, let me ask this dude. What area code will you be calling from? All right, this guy, Carmine Sabia. That's the guy who was supposed to call up earlier. I'm waiting to see if he's going to call up. Libby P, what's up? Let me see if this guy is going to call up. Now, that guy who's supposed to be this white conservative Christian, let me see if he's going to call up. Let's see what's popping. Hello, who's calling?
Hello? This is Cox the One. I usually comment on your...
I'm going to have you call back, brother. Shit. Calm down. I'm going to have you call back. Brother trying to get it in real fast. Because I want this dude, this suspected white supremacist, to call up. All right, what's up? Wait, no, that's wrong one. Hello? Now, hold on. Let me see if he's calling up. What's up? Who's calling?
Yes, this is Jimmy calling from Prairie View, Texas.
I'm going to have you call back, Jimmy. All right, I'm gonna find out what area code this dude is trying to call from. Because now everybody and their mom is trying to call. And I want this one dude to call up. He said he was trying to call. I'm looking at him on Twitter. He's probably, I don't know, he might be, he think that the show is over. I don't know if he thinks the show is over and he's going to use that as an excuse. He said he tried to call for 20 minutes and there was a busy signal. So don't nobody call in except the Carmine dude. What's up, who's calling? Hello? All right. So nobody call in unless it's the Carmine dude. What's up, who's calling?
Yo, Tariq, real quick, man. Yo.
Don't nobody call in except the Carmine dude. What's up? Who's calling?
Hey, what's up, man? It's K-Ray, man.
Have you called back? Okay. I hate hanging up on people, but I want to be very clear with the instructions now. I don't want to get sidetracked into some other shit. What's up? Who's calling?
Hey, this is Ralph from Pittsburgh.
I'm going to have you call back, Ralph. All right. All right, I'm going to have this dude. Let me see what he's going to do because I want to see if he's going to call up, see if he's brave enough to call up. He's listening now. I know you're listening, Carmine. Stop bullshitting. Carmine, stop bullshitting. Do not bullshit. All right, let's see who we got. Hello?
I was at the movies when that dude shot up the movies, bro.
Oh, what's up, new? Which theater? Which one?
It was crazy, bro, because it's like as soon as you walked in there.
Wait, stop, honey. Nigga, stop. What theater? What movie you talking about?
The one where the white man was telling me hi, brother.
There you go. Get your stupid ass off this phone, nigga. Yeah, I'm going to call this nigga back. Hold on. I'm about to call this nigga back. This nigga. Hold on 1 second. I'm calling your ass back.
Hello. Please state your name after the tone, and Google Voice will try to connect you.
El Chapo, calling collect from jail. Answer this phone, bitch, nigga.
Trust. Without it, there's no love.
Get off this phone. Yeah, fuck this phone. Oh, these niggas. Alright. So I'm still waiting on that dude to call up. I know niggas do anything to get on the line. Alright, let's see what we got here. So Carmine, I see you, dude. You punking out, Carmine. Carmine, you punking out, man. I know you're watching the show. Carmine the conservative. You're punking out, Carmine. All right. And don't forget, man, go to HiddenColorsFilm.com if you have not done that already. Go to HiddenColorsFilm.com. HiddenColorsFilm.com, ladies and gentlemen. And go to TariqElite.com and get that gear. TariqElite.com. Yeah, Carmine is listening right now. Carmine is listening right now. Now this troll just keeps on calling. Hold on. Let me give y'all this nigga's number. Y'all call this troll. Now this nigga just keeps calling over and over again. This troll. Hold on. This nigga keeps calling up. 2, 3, 8. All right. So the troll's number is 510-457-0238. So that's the troll who keeps calling. 510-457-0238. So call him. Y'all call the troll right now. You dig? Let's see who this is. What's up? Who's calling? Yo. Okay, these phones are real janky right now. Yeah, that's the troll number. 510-457-0238. My man said, I live in Atlanta. I don't know. Atlanta's too small for me. Yeah, Atlanta's a little too small for me. What's up? Who's calling? Excuse me. What's up? Hey, nigga, get your balls off the counter, nigga. All right. Excuse me. But, yeah, I wouldn't want to live in Atlanta. Atlanta's just a little bit too small for me right now. And I love L.A. This is my home.
What up, brother Tariq?
Well, I love it out here in L.A. Who is this, man?
Hey, man, this is, Nestle Pipes. Yeah, Nestle Pipes. This is Nestle Pipes following our cancer.
Yeah, let me get this moist bullshit off the phone, nigga. Yes, indeed. Man. This nigga said Nestle Pipe. This nigga called up with his moist booty name. Yo. This shit. Hello.
Hello.
All right. What's up? Who's this?
This is Hey, this is Jeff Benjamin. How are you doing?
What's your name?
Jeff Benjamin. I was just in the chat room.
Your name is Caitlyn Jenner. What's your name? Why you sound like a dude getting his booty ate? Hello?
I'm a scat man.
You still here? Hello? I'm gonna call them back. Hold on. I'm gonna call them back. That was clearly a dude trying to sound like a chick.
I'm a scat man.
Hello?
Hey.
Yes, how's
it going? Why you sound like that?
I'm a scat man.
You what?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
Now, what's your name again?
It was Jeff Benjamin. I was in the chat room.
And what's your name?
Jeff Benjamin.
Jeff?
Yes.
Your name is Jeff?
Yes, it is.
There's a real moist spirit going on tonight. There's a moist energy going on. That sounds like Cassandra right there. My Lord. Excuse me. But I want Carmine. I'm still waiting on Carmine. Carmine ain't going to call up. Carmine, you were bullshitting, Carmine. Let me tweet Carmine's ass. Carmine was up here fucking around. He was talking big shit and got scared to call in. Hold on, I'm about to hit him up on Twitter right now. Hold on. Hold on 1 second. I'm sending him a tweet. All right. So that's Carmine. I just tweeted him, and he's scared to call in. Carmine is scared to call in. How many people we got in the room right now, fam? How many people we got in the room? There you go. I banned Jeff. I got you, Jeff. So Jeff is, that's the one who, there you go. I banned you, Jeff. Finally got you. Man. Jeff Jenner, hilarious. She sounds like she got a big chest and smoke Newports. Hilarious. What's up, Bill? What's the latest about Bill Cosby? What happened with Bill Cosby? You know what I would like? I would like to find a clothing manufacturer in Africa to work with. I would love to do that. And as a matter of fact, what I want to do probably in the next few weeks, I will go to Ghana. I got to go tomorrow and check about the yellow fever shots and all that. But I do want to go to Ghana. I've been wanting to do that for a minute. So I'll get that popping. He's calling now. Okay. Okay, Carmine said he's about to call now. Let's see what's up. All right. I'm waiting. All right, let's see. Carmine says he's about to call up right now. Let's see what he does. Oh, yeah, I can't see for shit sometimes. Let's see what's going on. What did Bill Cosby do? He Yeah, I pretty much got all the people I'm going to get for Hidden Colors 4. I really want Minister Farrakhan. That's who I really want. I really, really wanted Minister Farrakhan for Hidden Colors 4. And that's another thing. People, don't email me. If you don't have a green light from Minister Farrakhan, or if you don't have him on the line or a direct message for him, you don't have to email me, family. Because now what happens, I'm getting hundreds of emails from people suggesting shit. Well, what you can do, you can call the office. What you can do, you can call my friend who went to school with his grandson. What you can do, please, no more, family. No more. All right, what's up? Who's calling?
This is Carmine.
Hey, Carmine, how are you? Been waiting on your call all night, Carmine. How are you, sir?
Brother had 20 minutes of busy signal from Cole before. You must have been a popular part of the show at that point.
Yes, indeed. A lot of folks were calling in. Now, Carmine, now explain to people exactly who you are and what you do. And I don't know too much about you. I know you have a radio show, a podcast or something like that, right?
Correct.
Okay, what's the name of your show?
It's called Parabellum.
Power who?
But I'm a Parabellum. It's Latin for prepare for war.
Oh, okay. Prepare for war. It's very deep.
It's an old saying, actually.
Yes, indeed. And,
but I'm also a political. I'm a political writer as well. So
now, who have you written for? By the way.
Well, we don't talk about that. Oh, but I'm a conservative political writer. There but we you. Don't. You know, I don't. I'm in unofficial business when I'm on the radio. So
there you go. So you hit me up earlier. You were saying that you were kind of criticizing me for supporting Asada Shakur. You were calling her a cop killer. You were kind of disparaging Sandra Bland, our sister.
I didn't disparage her. No, I didn't disparage her. I said she committed suicide.
Okay, which we don't have proof of that.
All signs point there, though. All signs point there. I'll say this.
Okay.
I'll say this, and I said this on the air tonight, and I said it on Twitter. She shouldn't have got arrested, and the cop was out of line in the arrest.
Right.
And his actions were out of line. All that we're copacetic on. All that we agree on. That was an overreach of power for a freaking taillight.
Right.
And for not putting out a cigarette. And that was an overreach. You know, and so cops like that, and I've spoken out against bad cops before. You know, nobody talks about, you know, and I always find it interesting that nobody talks about the Walter Scott thing that everybody can agree on.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? They talk about the fringe thing that, you know, for me to say Sandra Bland was murdered by a cop when there's absolutely no proof of that. Mm. There's no proof of that. And so to me, that's stretching for something that isn't there.
But there's no proof. But there's no proof that she killed herself. There's no proof of that.
Well, unless you get a videotape in the cell, you're not going to have proof one or the other. I mean, anybody who hangs themselves.
And that's the thing, sir. And that's the thing. All of a sudden, there's no video of the moment where she's allegedly supposed to have killed herself. And there's cameras all over the place. Jails have cameras. Cop departments have cameras. But magically, they don't have a camera there. So wouldn't that be suspicious to the average viewer?
If they have cameras in every other cell but hers, it's suspicious. But my understanding is they only have cameras in the hallways.
Okay. And the fact, but you have to admit, sir, there's a lot of red flags there, and some of those red flags, or most of the red flags, point to white supremacy and the system of white supremacy. Would you not agree with that?
I don't agree in the system of white supremacy, but
you don't agree with that?
I'm sorry?
You say you don't agree with that?
I don't agree there is a system of white supremacy. I don't, it depends on if you buy into it or not.
So let's touch on that. So you don't think that there's a system of white supremacy? It is or it's not. It's real simple.
It really does depend on if you buy into it or not. Because if you and I can't speak to the black experience. I'm not black, but right. What I can say is if you believe something is true, it becomes true for you.
Oh, so white supremacy is not just a belief. The reason why white supremacy is a problem is because the white supremacists can back up their belief with action. And that's documented proof that they can do this. So that's not a myth or that's not a belief. The white supremacists can pretty much back up their white supremacist views and ideology. Is that's either yes or no or right or wrong? Am I right or correct about that?
It depends. Yeah, no, yeah. In some cases, yes.
In some cases? What case can they not back up white supremacy? Name one case where the white supremacists cannot back up their white supremacist views.
White people go to jail all the time. White people get executed all the time. White people get killed by the cops all the time.
But that's more of a crime thing. That's not about, I don't think, white supremacy. If you commit a crime, you're supposed to go to jail, right?
If you have supremacy, then there wouldn't be more white people getting killed by cops than black people.
Well, no. Well, the thing is, you have black people are, 12% of the population, and we disproportionately get targeted by law enforcement, and we get killed disproportionately more per capita by the white supremacist law enforcement. And also, let me touch on that. White supremacy is a business, and there's going to be casualties of war and white sacrifices. So just because you have a few white people going to jail doesn't mean the system doesn't exist.
Well, jail is a business. That's a whole other conversation.
Yes, it is. But, yes, it is.
But let me say this. I'm glad you said about 12% of the population. Right. I get different numbers, 12, 13. But if that's the case, and you say disproportionately targeted by the cops.
Yes.
I say disproportionately covered by the media.
Mm.
But you say disproportionately attacked by the cops.
Yes.
I say to you, if you're only 12% of the population, why are you responsible for more than half the murders?
Because
that's, and who are you killing? You're killing other black people.
Well, we kill other black people at the same rate white people kill each other. And the thing is, when white people kill black people, a lot of times it's not considered murder. You understand? White people get away with more murders than black people. Black people don't get away with no crime. Black people, when we get killed by white supremacists, a lot of times they get away with it. So if you were to factor that in, the crime murder rate would be way more higher for the white supremacists. So we have people like George Zimmerman, who's not considered a murderer, by the way, because he didn't get convicted of murder, which we know he murdered a black kid. Some of these race soldier police officers, they kill black people all the time and they walk around free because it's not considered murder. When black people would get lynched in this country, it wouldn't be considered murder and you would have whole groups of people who would participate. So
we live in a system
of white supremacy. The system allows many white people to get away with certain crimes that black people wouldn't even think about getting away with. Correct?
Well, so you're making it a white thing, and I think it's more of a cop thing. I think cops get away with a lot more because they have a lot more leeway to kill.
No, they don't.
Because of their job description.
It's not a cop thing because cops are not killing unarmed white people at the same disproportionate rate. They're just not doing it. They're not killing white children. You can't point to white children getting killed by cops. Even white children who commit major crimes, white kids who shoot up schools don't even get killed by cops. Innocent black kids walking home, stealing something, they get shot in the brain by cops.
I'm glad you said that too.
Yes, sir.
Because the Dylan Roof thing got blown out of proportion when he got taken to Burger King. I was outraged, and I wrote on Twitter like, "This is ridiculous! How they take this guy to Burger King and this and that." But then I talked to some cops, and I found out this is common with when you're trying to get a guy to talk and get him on your team, and the good cop bad cop thing.
But
this
really,
is a common thing, and it was blown up.
Okay, did they really need to get Dylan Roof to talk? And he wrote a manifesto. I mean, he basically said, "I did it. Come get me." Yeah,
I don't think they knew that at the time.
Get him to talk.
They wanted to see if there. I think they wanted to see if there was other people involved. You know, is there other shooters?
Right.
But here's the thing: why Dylan Roof didn't get killed, and I have been very outspoken that when he did it, I said, "When you capture him, burn him alive." And I still stand by that. Mm-hmm. In taxpayers some money.
Mm-hmm.
But the reason Dylan Roof didn't get caught is because he actually put his hands up and said, "Don't shoot." Something Mike Brown did not do.
Sir, I saw the video of Dylan Roof. Sir, when they got Dylan Roof, many of those cops didn't even have their guns drawn, sir. That they treated this dude like they were taking him to the prom. They walked this dude around with kid gloves. Let's not be intellectually dishonest. I saw the video of Dylan Roof getting arrested. They just don't shoot white suspects like they shoot black suspects because they know that they cannot get away with it. Because you live in a system of white supremacy, and other white supremacists will protect you when you harm or kill a black person, and that's been historical in this country, sir.
I think you can get away with killing Dylan Roof. I don't think there would have been any outrage.
Oh, there would be outrage. If they killed Dylan Roof, that would be outrage. There was outrage over them killing the Branch Davidian people, the David Koresh. There's still outrage over them killing that idiot. And the white supremacists are mad at that. So there's outrage and there's backlash. You dig? So, but that there's same
outrage,
backlash.
There's outrage and backlash because of the way that went down. There's outrage and backlash. There's outrage. I was, I was outraged at that guy, and I can't, it's almost 1 o'clock in the morning here, but the black cop who they let burn alive in that.
Chris Dorner.
I mean, so that was outrageous to me. So there's things you do have to concern yourself with the police state coming into effect, and I think it affects everybody, but I think.
But that where? But do you, but when y'all say that, y'all, when people say, well, it affects everybody, and what you can do is only point to one or two white sacrifices like Dylan Taylor or somebody like that, that's not honest when you say it's affecting everybody when just week after week after week after week, black men, women, and children, even elderly, young, whatever, are getting disproportionately targeted by cops. We can't dismiss it as it's just a police state because the police are just really mainly targeting black people.
But I can speak to experience. I grew up, do you know where Newark, New Jersey is?
Yes, I do.
Okay, I'm born and raised in Newark, New Jersey.
Mm-hmm.
Now, fought my way out of the ghetto, got on top, making good money, but it was a long process.
Right.
But I lived in Newark, New Jersey for a long time. And I got to tell you, the blacker the neighborhood, the more the crime. That wasn't a racial thing. That wasn't a, hey, this is racist. That was a factual thing.
Oh.
That was a factual thing.
Ooh, now we're getting into something. Okay. So the blacker the neighborhood, the bigger the crime. So.
Where I live, absolutely. And I think you can point to statistics that would show that is actually factually accurate.
Okay.
And so the question becomes, why? Because it's not because of somebody's skin color that they're committing crimes, and it didn't used to be this way. This is a new phenomenon. Guess,
are we going to the family value stuff? Are we going to that?
No, not really.
Okay.
Actually,
okay,
we're going to a different form of. So I believe racism exists. I believe there are white racists that perpetuate this racism.
Okay,
but what we don't see is we don't see it coming from the same place. I firmly think, and I believe, and I think facts will back me up on this if we have a lot of time to get into it, the Democratic Party, which the black people vote for in mass, is responsible for the majority, and that whole the party switch thing is bullshit. Mm-hmm. The tactic switched.
Mm.
The party didn't switch. The Democratic Party has been enslaving black people from day one, fought against every civil right, fought against integration, fought to keep Jim Crow laws. The Confederate history they're wiping out now, find out what party all those Confederates belong to. It wasn't the Republicans. And what I would say to you is this. When you create a system now where you say that the black family, you're going to get more money if you don't get married. If you have kids, but have them out of wedlock, and we're going to give you more money, give you more welfare money. But we're going to put Planned Parenthoods in your neighborhoods because we really want to kill you all.
So it's the Democrats.
Like Margaret Sanger said. When she started Planned Parenthood, she wanted to kill off black people.
Mm-hmm.
And then you get into the rich white liberals who own 90% of the entertainment industry, pumping out the black stereotype of the criminal and the thug with the rap music and the movies. You see every black person looking like a thug, committing crime. Those are all liberals that are creating that stereotype.
Oh. Okay. Well, let me touch on all of that. Okay. Okay, the liberal stereotype. Okay, so the liberal stereotype. Well, first, the stereotypes of black people did not start in the 60s, okay? Black people in the conservative, the Woodrow Wilsons, all of these Republican politicians, these people were staunch white supremacists. Birth of a Nation, which was the first blockbuster movie in Hollywood, showed black people as negative. So they've always showed black people as negative in the media, going back to the food product, putting black people on cream of wheat boxes and pancake boxes looking like slaves. So the media has always, conservative.
Did you just call Woodrow Wilson a Republican?
Not him. Woodrow Wilson and other Republicans like him. There were Republican presidents who were just as racist as him.
Woodrow Wilson was a Democrat. He was the most racist president we ever had.
But you brought up Margaret Sanger, sir, who was a Republican.
Margaret Sanger was a Democrat.
She was a Republican, sir. Margaret Sanger was a Republican.
No, I don't believe that.
Sir, I'm going to Google. I put up a Google search for your partner earlier, but Margaret Sanger
was possible.
She's a Republican. I'm going to find that link again. I put it up earlier on Twitter for your partner. You had your friend talking about the Democrats are baby killers and all that, and Margaret Sanger. All right, I'm going to put the link up. Sanger. She was a Republican. And sir, and you said something about the Confederate. What did you say about them? The Democrat Confederate. What do you say about them?
If you look up the history of the Confederate Party, mostly that we're talking about Democrats here.
But you do know there were Republican slave owners too, right?
Of course.
All right. It's all birds of a feather. They all work together, sir. I don't get into that whole Democrat-Republic thing because even black people voted Republican for a long time. And when black people voted Republican, things were not better. That was in the height of Jim Crow. Black people were getting lynched and disenfranchised at the same rate, sir. So I don't go into that whole Democrat-Republican thing.
I would tell you that, and this is going to be a controversial statement, yes. It was worse for black people back then. I'm not going to say that, but financially, I think it's actually worse today.
Oh, yeah, I believe so, too. I believe so, too. I definitely believe so, too, because we gave up the businesses that we had. We used to own businesses, and we were...
Correct.
Yeah, we used to own a lot of stuff, and then we thought that we would be integrated, and then we gave all of that up, and that was a major mistake. But I don't think that has nothing to do with a Democrat or a Republican at all.
I think it does, because Republicans will tell you that the path to becoming more enfranchised, to the path to a better quality of life, is through becoming small business owners again and financial freedom. See, money creates power. Money creates power. What the black community needs to do is wrap their hands around the money. You understand? Once you get the money, once you have money power, you have real power. Voting power is bullshit. Money power is what makes things happen.
I totally agree with that. But the problem is this. The white supremacists, who are Republicans and Democrats, they have all worked to economically disenfranchise black people and sabotage any type of black financial progress. They've done this all across the board with all white unions that would push out black workers. They would do this in the housing market, where they would not allow black people to purchase homes, especially after World War II, where they allowed white people to get these cheap homes, which basically created the modern white middle class. Black people were shut out from that and pushed into these ghettos and these disenfranchised places. So all the white supremacists, they work in concert.
I agree with that.
Democrat and Republican, to disenfranchise black people economically. So that's why it all goes back to the white supremacists. So when we talk about Democrats and Republicans, I mean, shit, any president did something for black people specifically? You can't point to any.
Not anything good, no. But I really can.
Yeah.
The only thing I can point to is economic freedom and a chance to get economic freedom. And I think we have that on our ticket this year. I really do.
Right.
I
don't give a damn about none of them, to be honest. I agree. But the thing is, why don't you, if you know what the problem is, if you know that the issue is really systematic white supremacy that's orchestrating the disenfranchisement of black people, why, instead of saying, well, look at all the black crime, why don't you look at the people who create the environment that creates crime, which are the white supremacists?
I was touching on this before. When you push people into ghettos and you push them and you pack them in like sardines, you're going to have crime.
Right.
You know? So I absolutely agree with that. But at a certain point, you have to fight your way out of it. I fought my way out of it. You know, my friends that were on my radio show before, the guys you were calling, I think probably your viewers wouldn't think are black enough. They got their way out of it. I went to school. I went to a private school. I was fortunate enough. My mom worked her ass off, again, living in Newark, New Jersey. Worked her ass off to send me to private school. I went to public school for the last 2 years of my life.
Right.
So I did get to the
So you're going to do the, well, I pulled myself up by the bootstraps thing. Because if we're going to do that, you got to understand this. You got to give us some damn bootstraps to pull up. And there's a lot of black people out here, and I've so-called made it. I live in a very nice area, but I'm not naive, and I'm not.